Pretty much everything that NBC News and the New York Times have told you about the war in Ukraine is a lie. The Russian army is incompetent, they claim. Ukraine is a democracy. Vladimir Putin is Hitler and he's trying to take over the world. Thankfully, the Ukrainians are winning. None of that is true. Every claim is false, the last one especially. The Ukrainian army is not winning. In fact, it's losing badly. Ukraine is being destroyed. Its population is being slaughtered in lopsided battles with a technologically superior enemy, or scattered by the millions to the rest of the globe as refugees. Ukraine is running out of soldiers. As that happens, the question will inevitably arise, who's going to replace them? If the Ukrainians can't beat Putin, who will? The answer, of course, will be us. American troops will fight the Russian army in Eastern Europe. That's most likely. And the assumption is we'll win. But will we win? Probably not, says former Army Colonel Douglas McGregor, a decorated combat veteran who advised the Secretary of Defense in the last administration. The U.S., says McGregor, is on the brink of a catastrophic war that could very easily destroy us. Few Americans seem to understand that, but they should. Doug McGregor is now the CEO of Our Country, Our Choice, and we sat down with him recently. This conversation is worth hearing. Doug McGregor, thanks for joining us. How would you assess and describe the state of the war in Ukraine right now?
That's an important question, and not enough people have good answers at this point. I think all of the lies that have been told for more than a year and a half about the Ukrainians are winning, the Ukrainian cause is just, the Russians are evil, the Russians are incompetent, all of that is collapsing. And it's collapsing because what's happening on the battlefield is horrific. Ukrainians now, we think, have lost 400,000 men killed in battle. We were talking about 300, 350,000 a few months ago. Within the last month of this supposed counteroffensive, which was to sweep the battlefield, they lost at least 40,000 killed. We don't even know how many people have been wounded, but we know that probably upwards of 40 to 50,000 soldiers are amputees. We know the hospitals are full. And we know that Ukrainian units at the platoon and company level, that's with anywhere from 50 to 150 to 200 men, are in piecemeal fashion surrendering to the Russians. Not because they don't want to fight, it's because they can't fight anymore. They have so many wounded, they can't evacuate them. And commanders are saying, well, if I can't evacuate my wounded, I'm going to surrender, because otherwise the wounded will die. And so they call the Russians, and they all speak Russian, and tell them on the radio, look, I've got 50, 60 wounded here. I'm going to surrender because I don't want them to be killed. And the Russians from the very beginning have always treated the Ukrainian soldiers very fairly and very gently. And so they know they're not going to be abused or mistreated. They know they can actually be exchanged for Russian prisoners in the future. So they've surrendered. And I think we're going to see this army that we've been spending so heavily on increasingly melt away. And at the same time as we're talking, if you look at this long banana-shaped strip of territory in southern Ukraine that the Russians control, if you go to the northeastern corner of that, south of this city called Kharkiv, there are major offensive operations taking place there right now. And the Ukrainian forces are being swept away in front of the Russians. And again, all of this happens in a way that is just not reported in the West. And in the meantime, rather than admit that this is a terrible tragedy that should be ended on humanitarian grounds, if no other, that the killing should stop, as President Trump said, stop the killing, we're going to continue. And this puts the Russians in the unhappy position of marching further west, because from the very beginning, Putin and his advisors were never interested in a war with NATO or the United States. That's why you've had such incrementalism, the slow grind of movement forward, defensive operations for a long period to build up the force, and then continued offensive operations. They have over 300,000 combat troops in reserve in Russia. And I think they're sitting there and not being released to fight because President Putin anticipates the possibility that we will intervene in Western Ukraine. And if we intervene in Western Ukraine, the Russians will be ready for that. And the consequences for us and for NATO will be devastating because we are not ready to fight the Russians.
Why?
Oh, I think the readiness has been on the decline for a long time. You've had an almost steady, uninterrupted decline in the discipline that makes soldiers fight. Discipline is a tough thing. We don't always understand it. Discipline is really a form of habit, and you build those habits over time through repetition, but you also build it under stress, under pressure, so that it sinks in. And then you build cohesion within the framework of those units. You don't build cohesion when you're dividing the force on racial grounds, when you're pushing people who are clearly unqualified up the ranks to command, when you're rewarding people for anything other than demonstrated character, competence, and intelligence. All of those things are demoralizing, destructive to military establishments. The Army and the Marines are suffering with it, so is the Air Force and the Navy. And there's no easy fix. And these cracks that are just cracks at the moment will become giant fissures if you go to war.
So you spent the bulk of your adult life as an Army officer, went to West Point, commanded troops in battle. You're a combat veteran, decorated. But you entered the Army right at the tail end of Vietnam.
That's right.
When it was famously at its nadir.
Yes.
How would you compare the readiness of the current U.S. Armed Forces to, say, 1975 at the end of Vietnam?
I think that in terms of morale and discipline, we are close to where we were in the late 70s. We have a lot of people that are confused about what needs to be done. We've lost a sense of what's right. In other words, you don't have people that have served long enough in formations to know what right looks like, so that you can see a battle group, whether it's a battalion size or brigade or larger, and you know what makes things work. You know what it takes to fight in battle. We don't have very many people like that because since 2001, most of the fighting has been on a very small scale against a fleeting enemy, you know, running around in sandals with an AK-47, relying heavily on explosives, mines to kill and maim Americans. About 87% of our losses were really a result of explosives that came from mines. This is not an army that is accustomed to fighting anybody who can fight back. If I were going to compare it to an army, a better comparison would probably be the French army before the Franco-Prussian War, because the French had fought Mexican bandits, Mexican rebels. They'd fought Arab bandits, Arab insurgents. They'd had a little experience fighting disgruntled, demoralized European troops, Austrians in northern Italy, but they hadn't faced a truly modern enemy. But people were convinced that the French army was the greatest army in the world because they'd fought in North Africa, in Indochina, Mexico, all over the world. That war was a catastrophe for France, and that army was decimated in months by a Prussian army that was a modern force, highly disciplined, very competently led, trained, and equipped. So we're not there. We have equipment that is decades old. The tanks that I served on, for instance, when I went to war in 1990, were virtually brand new, state of the art. Those tanks are still out there. They've been rebuilt, but they're not new anymore. They're no longer as capable as they once were. You know, I'll give you a quick example. We have a turbine engine in the M1 A1 series tanks, and that turbine engine burns up as much fuel sitting still as it does moving because it's a turbine engine. It was designed to be used on an aircraft. We put them into tanks. So that means you've got an 8-hour tank. Every 8 hours, if you're operating, you've got to refuel this thing. This thing also burns fuel at a very, very high temperature, over 1,000 degrees. And there are 40-plus connections around the engine that are very brittle that can easily cause fires if they accidentally touch these little tubes that carry various types of fluid, if they actually touch this engine that's burning so hot. So the engine is so hot that you can track the movement of U.S. Army ground forces with tanks from low Earth orbiting satellites. So if you think you're going to hide or conceal yourself or outpace somebody, you're just a glowing target from space. To this must be added the ridiculousness of not having replaced that engine with a reliable state-of-the-art diesel electric engine, which is much cooler, which can go for 24 hours or more without a refuel. And these things are extremely problematic when you go to war because you have to pull forces back, refuel them, return them to the front. That's not easy to do when you're operating as frequently as every 8 or 6 or 9 hours. They say, well, we put it all, I guess, a generator on there to make up for this when you're sitting still. The problem is that you don't sit still for very long in combat, because if you do, you're going to be targeted and destroyed. And that, of course, is what we're seeing in Ukraine. Persistent surveillance from space, from overhead surveillance, makes everything visible all the time. So if you're going to embed yourself in the ground, if you're going to set up a permanent position there where you try to fire from that, you're going to be targeted and destroyed very, very quickly. So that's why this defense right now looks a lot like World War I, because anybody who moves is identified and killed. The only limitation on your ability to target and destroy the enemy is ammunition. The Russians, of course, have no shortages whatsoever. You recall at the beginning of this, we have all these shortages, right? The Russians can't keep up with missiles. The Russians can't keep up with shells. Well, they have multiple manufacturing facilities operating 7 days a week at 24 hours a day. We have no surge capacity in the United States. It would take us many, many months to come up to that kind of standard where we could actually compete in high-end conventional warfare. And that's why people like me and others worry that if we get into a confrontation, that we cannot win, because the world has changed, warfare has changed, integrated air defenses will knock virtually everything that flies out of the sky, that we will then fall back on a nuclear deterrent, a tactical nuclear weapon that says, if you keep advancing, we'll have to use a nuclear weapon. We don't want to go there, because the notion that there are so-called tactical nukes, you've heard that expression?
Yes.
Oh, that's just a little nuke. So that won't precipitate a major war. The use of any nuclear weapon is going to precipitate escalation very rapidly, because your opponents will assume that if they don't use their nuclear weapons, they're going to lose them. So we're living in a terrible dilemma right now. The smartest thing that we can do is end this war.
What is Russia's objective, do you believe? Assuming that objectives change over the course of a
Of
war, right?
course. Well, the original objective obviously was very different. I mean, if they'd made peace with the Russians back in, let's say, March or April, I think the Russians would have retained very little territory, probably only Luhansk and Donetsk, the two so-called breakaway provinces. And I think there would have been guarantees of neutrality for Ukraine and guarantees of equal rights before the law for Russians. And that's what people don't understand. Most of this has to do with abuse meted out to Russians in Ukraine by the Ukrainian government. And this, of course, is this radical nationalist government that came to power in Kiev in 2014. And they almost immediately, as soon as that government came into power, they started launching a war against the so-called breakaway provinces. And Putin kept trying and trying and trying. The Minsk Accords were another good example, trying to get to a solution that would not involve confrontation. Now we know, of course, thanks to Angela Merkel, the German chancellor, that the Minsk Accords were just a ruse, a way to kill time and give the Ukrainians more time to build up their forces. To build up their forces for what? And it's pretty clear they were building up for an offensive against Russia. And of course, the next step was that we bring in our missiles and station them in eastern Ukraine, which puts them in a couple of minutes away from all of Russia's cities and all of Russia's nuclear deterrent. So this was unacceptable. So that original deal is gone now. And the question is, what will the Russians accept? Well, I think they're going to demand that whatever remains of Ukraine, Rump Ukraine is what most people are calling it now, most of what's probably west of the Dnieper River has to be neutral. It can't be part of NATO. The Russians will never tolerate NATO forces on Ukrainian soil, because we've demonstrated conclusively that we are fundamentally hostile to Russia. So that's the minimal requirement. How that's governed, that's another question. Who knows? I'm sure Moscow would want to have some say in that government, and who is there to ensure that behind the scenes they are not once again subjected to the treatment that we subjected to them to in the Minsk Accords.
What is the Ukrainian objective?
I think more and more Ukrainians just want to survive this, and that's becoming very hard. And Zelensky and the radicals around him are basically committed to fighting this war to the last Ukrainian. And of course, I'm sure that Mr. Zelensky and his friends are anxious at some point to retire to their estates in Florida or Venice, or Cyprus, to collect on the billions that they've managed to steal or siphon from all the aid that we've provided. Remember, Ukraine is probably one of the most corrupt places in the world. A friend of mine who had spent time in the old Soviet Union and also lived in Mexico came back from a visit to Mexico, and he said, it's hard to believe this, but Ukraine is more corrupt than Mexico.
Wow.
And I think that's true. So this is a world-class disaster. 14 million Ukrainians have left the nation, presumably never to return, because when they're asked in Germany or France or Croatia or Spain or wherever they go, we will never go back. So what are you going to do with this country? And then, of course, we have the usual suspects, the great agricultural business conglomerates, along with BlackRock, who have their eyes on the fertile Ukraine ground in Western Ukraine. I suppose there'll be a big effort to get control of that in some fashion. That may not work, though, once this war ends with a complete and utter defeat of the Ukrainian regime.
Who is Zelensky? Exactly. How would you characterize Zelensky?
Well, Zelensky...
George W. Bush called him our generation's Winston Churchill.
Well, this is W, right?
Yeah.
Not a very thoughtful man. He was a comedian who made a living acting on stage, frequently pretending to be a transvestite, doing things with various body parts that I won't go into. And he was picked up by an oligarch named Kolomoisky. Kolomoisky is the individual who is probably more responsible than anybody else for funding this atrocity we call the Azov Regiment that runs around with the swastikas and Nazi gear and so forth. And he was picked and then blessed by Victoria Nuland and the State Department as their man. Now, when he originally ran for office, he ran on a peace platform. And he was overwhelmingly elected across the country because he said, if I am elected as your president, I will make peace with Russia. Ukrainians didn't want to go to war with Russia. They were looking for a way out of this and a resolution to the crisis. Of course, once he was in there, he took a different road. And I can't help but think that that road was defined for him by us.
Who is Victoria Nuland?
Oh, goodness gracious. All these hard questions. I do not know Victoria Nuland personally. I know Fred Kinnegan, and his brother Bob is married to her. And she's a long-term committed neocon. This is someone I would not characterize as either Democrat or Republic. These are people with this agenda. And the agenda says until the entire world is garrisoned by U.S. forces and is converted forcibly to some form of democracy that we approve of, the world will not be safe and we must continue to fight. And I think in the case of Russia, Russia has special appeal because I think these people have ancestors who came from that region of the world and have a permanent axe to grind with the Russians, which of course I don't. I don't think most Americans do, and nor do I think anybody in government should shape policy based on whatever unhappiness their ancestors, you know, experienced in a place like Russia. So that's a nutshell, but I think that's enough. And wherever she goes, usually there is conflict, crisis, and fighting. And she's a strong opponent of fighting to the last Ukrainian.
Do you think have relevant experience that would qualify her to be in charge of this war?
Well, obviously she does. But, you know, it's sort of like asking somebody who has never snaked a drain or replaced a garbage disposal to be a plumber. And I think we have a lot of those in Washington. She's not the only one. So, no, I don't think she understands the gravity of the situation. These are the same people. Tony Blinken is in this with, Sullivan in the, I keep mixing up Sullivan with the previous O'Brien, who was in the White House. Not much difference. And Sullivan will all tell you, well, you know, the Russians are weak. The Russian economy is fragile. The Russian armed forces are poor. Their generals are terrible. And they can't possibly win. All we have to do is to keep up the pressure and they will collapse. Well, that's been a hell of a strategy. And it's killed large numbers of people and created millions of refugees and destroyed the country. But it hasn't hurt Russia. And Russia today is stronger than it has been in 30 or 40 years. You have a Russian military establishment that is now more potent and more capable than the Russian military was in the mid-1980s.
Why? wars typically, don't they degrade a military force?
Well, the Russians have been very, very careful and deliberate, very cautious about the expenditure of life.
What do you think the casualty numbers are in Russia?
You know, that's a hard one to estimate. I think probably 50,000, 40 to 50,000 killed, maybe another 40 to 50,000 wounded.
Wait, total?
Yes.
As compared to the Ukrainian?
400,000 dead. Yeah.
So this is...
The ratio is 1 to 5.
And you believe those numbers are roughly accurate?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. And these
50,000 to 400,000, that's a larger country or with a much smaller country with a much smaller military. I mean, that's a grotesque...
Oh, it is. And the manpower is leaving Ukraine as quickly as it could get out because people don't want to be thrown into the meat grinder. You can't defeat what the Russians have built. They were the first back in the 1970s to understand the criticality of linking intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance in space, as well as on land and at sea, with strike weapons. What's a strike weapon? Rockets, missiles, guided artillery for precision. They've done that extremely well. So that's one of the reasons they have thousands of guns, hundreds of rocket launchers, hundreds of ballistic missile launchers, cruise missiles, and so forth. And these are then linked to that ISR. So the response time is almost instantaneous. A Ukrainian formation is located at this spot next to this building on the outskirts of, say, Kharkov. They can have missiles on the way to those targets or rockets or drones within the space of perhaps 5, 6, 7 minutes. So this is a very well-structured, well-organized machine. And the machine is grinding up everything in front of it. And it's not going to be defeated.
What about the space-age military technology that we've been sending to Ukraine? That hasn't brought parity?
Well, first of all, a lot of the equipment we send over there is quite frankly obsolete. It's very old. It's not new. We've given them a few new items, but not much. And remember what I said about missiles. We sent them some Patriot missiles. And I think at this point in this newest round of money, what, $750 million, something like that, we're sending 33 missiles, Patriot missiles. These are missiles that are used to shoot down aircraft or cruise missiles, incoming opposing forces. Every time you're in air defense, people will tell you if there's a target out there, you shoot two missiles at it as a minimum, to make sure you get the target. Well, you run out of our missiles in the space of a few days. 33 missiles will be gone in 2 or 3 days. You can't possibly defeat the thousands of projectiles that are being hurled in your direction. And the radars, of course, emit, and so your radars light up and become targets. This is a no-win situation because the Russians, though they were not prepared in February 2022 for this kind of war, they are now. And they're continuing to prepare, which includes continuous mobilization. They're up to 750,000 troops in and around Ukraine. Most of them are on the outskirts, Belarusia, Western Russia, down in southern Ukraine. That number is going to rise over the next year, I would expect, to 1.2 million. And people are being reservists, being called out of universities. People are being through the military now, working in universities to become engineers, architects, mathematicians, whatever. They're being pulled out, put in uniform, and readied. Because, again, our intransigence, our demonstrated hatred and hostility for Moscow and for Russia has convinced the Russian people, as well as the leadership in Moscow, that they are going to have to fight us and anyone who is allied with us. So they're preparing for that eventuality. That's why it's so important that we have to wake up, understand what we've done has backfired. Whatever we set out to achieve has failed. What we need to do now is stop this and come to a settlement that we may not like, but it needs to happen and soon, before this thing is out of control. Eventually, you keep this up within the next 6, 8 months, you'll see hundreds of thousands of Russian troops on the Polish border. That is not what we set out to achieve.
No, it's a terrifying disaster. At what cost do you think to the United States?
The latest estimates since 2001 spending, including the spending in Ukraine, all the military spending designed to support these interventions, conflicts, wars, whatever you want to call them, about $14 trillion. Now, that $14 trillion is largely debt financed. So then you have to move from the $14 trillion to where we stand now in national sovereign debt, which, of course, I know the economic luminaries think is meaningless. But you have 130 million workers, and you look at those figures, and suddenly you realize that every adult male or woman in the United States who works for a living has a debt hanging over them of roughly $240,000 in order to deal with what the $14 trillion have added to the national sovereign debt. And this is part of the issue that people are walking away from this war for good reasons. Look, the average American earns about $31,000 a year. That's it. The average American pays about $16,600 a year. Now, the people in Congress, this doesn't affect them or in the Hill or inside the Beltway. We're talking about the real Americans who live out there scratching out a living. Keep in mind that a person who works all his life and then tries to draw on Social Security can expect a monthly payment of probably $1,400, if they're lucky, $1,400. We hand every alleged asylum seeker, illegal migrant, pouring into the border in Texas or wherever else, we hand them when they get there $2,200. And we put them on that $2,200 diet from there on out per month. Yet somebody who works all his life, retires and draws Social Security, gets $1,400. The Afghans who were hanging on to the planes in Kabul, trying to come to the United States, when they arrived, they received $2,200 a month. Now, if you can make sense out of this, please try, because I don't think most Americans can make sense out of this at all. And that's one of the reasons people have said, not because they know anything about Ukraine. Most Americans don't. If they knew anything about the history of Eastern Europe, they would all say, get out. Because the wars and the blood and the hatred that have been characterized to that part of the world for hundreds of years is something we can't sort out. We can't fix it. We shouldn't try to arbitrate it. We don't know anything about it. We shouldn't be in this, is the bottom line. I think Americans have figured that out. But now they're beginning to look at the numbers and the figures, and they say, what happened to consent by the governed? Instead, we have contempt for the governed. Whatever the governed want, they don't get. Who gets it? Well, the donors get what they want. You know, somebody was joking the other day and said, you know, Doug, if the donors were cannibals, they'd feed the American people to them. That's the attitude in Washington, D.C. What's the donor want? Give me more money. It's a catastrophe. It's the destruction of our whole republic. And I don't think people realize how far gone things are. A lot of Americans sense it. And I think we're on the path to some sort of national come to Jesus moment, where we're tired of being the contemptibles. We want to have a say in what our government does, and we really don't have it.
You mentioned the donors, and we just had a conversation with Vivek Ramaswamy running for president, Republican side. He's rich, and so he doesn't need big donors. But he has said publicly that he can't get money from any big-time Republican donor because his position on Ukraine is similar to yours. He doesn't buy the NBC News version of the Ukraine war. Why are donors on both sides so attached to a war that's clearly hurting the United States?
Well, first of all, you've got to go through and identify the donors. What's their background? Where did they come from? And why do they feel the way they do? I think there are more personal issues here than we realize with many of them. Secondly, you have to look at the monetary benefits to them. If they're heavily, it's not just being heavily invested in the defense industry. You've seen that report from the Oakland Institute, which talks about arable land in Ukraine, the breadbasket of Europe, some of the richest, most fertile soil anywhere in the world. A friend of mine who's Ukrainian said, all you have to do is take an old boot, stick it in the ground in Ukraine, come back in 6 months and something grows. the boot's transformed into something you can eat. He said, that's how fertile this is. So there are people that are interested in getting control of it, oligarchs. They call them oligarchs in Eastern Europe. I'm starting to think that we should talk about oligarchs in the West.
Well, of course.
Because they're also invested in this. They have an interest in it. So that's part of it. Then, of course, you have the advantages of people on the Hill. You have somebody like McConnell who says, we're so fortunate that we're doing so much damage to the Russians. This will set them back for 10 years. They've lost all this equipment. The Ukrainians have done a great job. Well, of course, all that's a lie. That's a blatant falsehood. And then he follows up by saying, and we're offloading equipment so that we can replenish with newer equipment. Well, unfortunately, the new equipment we're going to buy looks an awful lot like the old equipment. So you're not necessarily getting new top-of-the-line material. You're just getting new versions of what you've already got, which, of course, is what Congress wants. Unfortunately, that doesn't prepare you for a future war because your probable opponents are investing in very different capabilities from the ones that you have. And remember, again, all the things that we once monopolized, all the precision, all of that's lost now. Everybody has it. There's nothing that we can do that they cannot also do in Moscow, in Beijing, and probably in many other countries that we don't even know about yet. But of course, it all means money. You know, where does the money go? Does it go into the Defense Department? Sure. But then it's transferred over into industry. And industry then contributes money to PACs. And the PAC money goes where? Back to the Hill. So it's a wonderful sort of recycling machine where the wash is washed again and again. Now, what happens in Ukraine? Well, the equipment shows up. Some of the equipment reaches the troops. A lot of it is sold off, ends up in arms bazaars like Kosovo, or we see it now being used by the drug cartels. We saw somebody working for one of the major cartels that is also involved in human trafficking walking around with a Javelin missile. The whole kit. Well, where did that come from? Well, it came from Europe. Probably may have gone from Europe to Afghanistan, Europe to North Africa, Europe to the Balkans, and then over into the United States, south of the border.
What, I mean, you can't be the only person who spent your life as an Army officer has reached these conclusions. Like, what are they thinking at the Pentagon? There have to be people who've come to the same positions.
Tucker, we have right now, I think, 43, could be 44. It's usually 43 or 44, four-star generals and admirals. You have to think about that. We have a force of 1.1.
Seems like a lot.
Well, let me explain just how much it is. We have 1.12 million people in the armed forces. In other words, you add up all the armed services, that 1.12 million. In World War II, at the height of the war, end of 42, beginning of 43, when we had 12.2 million men under arms, we had seven four-stars. I can tell you who they were. You had George Marshall, Chief of Staff of the Army, Douglas MacArthur commanding in the Pacific, Eisenhower commanding in Great Britain and in the European theater, Hap Arnold for the Air Force. Unofficially, he was the vice chief, but he was effectively commanding the air forces. And then you had Leahy, who was in the White House, Admiral Leahy as the liaison officer. He was effectively the unofficial chairman of the Joint Chiefs for FDR. Then you had Nimitz and King. King was the CNO, and Nimitz commanded in the Pacific. Now, somehow or another, with only seven four-stars, we managed to survive the greatest, most destructive war in history and fortunately end up on the quote-unquote winning side. Now, we are blessed with 43 to 44 four-stars organized into multiple commands designed to blanket the globe with American military power and interest. I think it borders on lunacy, especially since we don't live in the world of 1920, 1945. This is the 21st century. Today, if you have forces forward, they're easy to identify, easy to target, easy to destroy. So what's the point of having a lot of forces forward? Well, we can always reinforce them. No, you can't. How do you get across these vast oceans, the Atlantic and the Pacific, when your opponents have submarine fleets? How many ships do they have to sink? Supply ships, transports, before everybody says, that's it, we're not going. Same thing true for aircraft. Well, we have better aircraft. We may have better aircraft, but we don't have very good air defenses. We've neglected air and missile defenses for years. In the Army, they always treated theater air and missile defense as sort of the redheaded stepchild, because we haven't fought anybody that compelled us to defend ourselves from missile and air attack. Well, those days are over. In other words, if you press this war with Russia in Central East Europe, it will reach us here in the United States. People aren't thinking about that.
How many Americans do you think are assisting or fighting on the side of Ukraine right now?
Well, I don't know, but I imagine it must be hundreds, because the President of the United States, as you know, has authorized combat pay for Americans in uniform in Ukraine. Now, didn't specifically say uniform, just said Americans serving in Ukraine. So I imagine large numbers are in other uniforms, not necessarily American. Some may be assisting contractors or working with them, but a substantial number. And again, thus far, the Russians have been very careful about not necessarily targeting them. And it would be a mistake to assume that the Russians don't know where they are. And the latest strikes that we've had over the last couple of months have been all the way out on the border with Romania, the border with Poland, the border with Moldova. Precision strikes, Kinzhal missiles carrying 1,000-pound warheads, great accuracy, very destructive. Why? The Russians are sending a message. If you think you're going to hide from us if you come in here, you're not going to do that. If you cross these borders, we will annihilate you. You'll never get to the Dnieper River. We won't permit it. And we need to come to terms with these realities, because we can't defeat it. And see, this is the sad part. Somebody will say to me, well, Doug, you know, you don't sound very patriotic. I'm not patriotic. I put my life on the line for the country. I have no compunction about fighting or killing anybody if we need to do it. Don't get me wrong. We don't need to do this. That's the point. This is unnecessary. And
a lot of Americans suspect that maybe our military force is weaker than we think it is. You're saying it's much weaker than we think it is.
Think of it like an engine. You have a 500 horsepower engine in 1991, and the 500 horsepower engine goes from 500 to 400 to 300 to 200 down to 100. Now, you don't notice very much, because you don't put the pedal to the metal. It's good enough to get to the grocery store. It's good enough to drive on 95 for 50 miles. But if you put your foot down the pedal, you're going to discover that this is a very weak engine. It's not performing very well. It doesn't have what it once had. In other words, we've gone down in the horsepower arena militarily. This is the warning. This is what people need to understand. People say, well, what about all the money we spent? That's a damn good question. You spend all this money, what are you getting for it? Where did the money go? Who's making the decisions? And you have separate services. Each service lives in its own world, has its own doctrine, its own bureaucracy, its own way of war. All this jointness is just, you know, fugazi nonsense. And you got lots of generals, and every general has a reason to exist. And every general has 1,000 men in his headquarters, every four-star. And every four-star needs money for his projects. And this becomes a giant trough feeding frenzy for people on the Hill. And nobody ever bothers to stand up and say, why? What are we doing this for? I mean, just look at what's happening in Africa. Niger decided they'd had enough of their French overlords. You know, the French retained ownership of virtually 50% of everything of value in their colonies in Afrique du Nord. Now, that's French business. Whatever the French want to do, it's fine with me. But my point is, we're involved there because we built an airstrip in Niger, and we marched in there to defeat Islamists. The truth is, there weren't very many Islamists until we showed up. Now there are lots of Islamists. What's wrong with that picture? And now it turns out the whole population, in addition to hating the French, has decided they hate us. So we've had a coup in Niger. It's now being backed by the Algerians, as well as the neighbors. And people are saying, well, We trained them. We gave them assistance, and they're turning on us. Oh, it must be the Wagner mercenaries. There are any Wagner mercenaries in the place. In other words, that we may have gone in there and blown it on our own, made mistakes of our own, backed the wrong horse, whatever you want to call it, doesn't occur to anybody. Well, it must be those Russians or maybe those pesky Chinese. We have this unfortunate habit of seeing ourselves as always wearing the white hat, always doing everything right, and we miss the truth. And the truth is, soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines do what they're told. They'll go wherever you ask them to go. They'll put their lives on the line. But it doesn't always make sense. And sometimes it may be for profit, not for national interest, not for the interests of the American people. And that's the problem. And no one's been watching this thing. They see the flag, everybody salutes, everybody listens to the music, everyone's enthralled. But the old 500 horsepower engine is gone. We're down to 100 horsepower. And 100 horsepower engine is trying to make it all over the world. It's not going very well. And we haven't even talked about our economy, obviously.
Given all of this, I mean, what you're saying is horrifying. And some of it, with respect, does seem kind of obvious. Almost nobody in the Congress is saying what you are saying. Chris Christie never served in the Congress, but he was a governor. He's been on the national stage for quite a long time. He's running for president now. He recently went to Ukraine to meet with the world's highest paid actor who runs it. I think we have a clip.
I believe that the overwhelming majority of the American people understand that we need to be with Ukraine on this fight.
Do you maintain the current commitment? Do you expand it or do you contract it?
I increase it.
My position on Ukraine, which is that we haven't done enough. And that while I think that President Biden has certainly done better than President Trump, and President Trump did better than President Obama on this, we still have more to go.
We can spend this money now and have Ukrainian soldiers fight our war, or we can spend a lot more money and American blood later to fight in Taiwan.
How do you respond to that?
When we were in Vietnam, I was 16, and I remember General Westmoreland telling everyone, we don't fight these people in Vietnam, and to fight them here, we'll be fighting them in Los Angeles and in all our major cities. So we have to stay here and win this, or that's what's going to happen.
A lot of them did go to Los Angeles and build thriving businesses, actually, in the end.
Well, my hat's off to them. That's fine. I have no problems with that. But I think it's a lot of nonsense. You know, it's the same thing with Ukraine.
But Chris Christie's not stupid. He's very dishonest, obviously, but he's not stupid.
Well, he has donors.
That's what that is.
Of course. Where's he going to get his money?
Well, there, Governor Christie, we want this war in Ukraine. We want to see that man Putin removed. We got to get rid of him and his regime.
Why?
Well, you know, it's not democratic. Most of the world is not democratic. There are a lot of people that don't think we're very democratic anymore.
We're not.
So who are we kidding? I think Americans are waking up. And Christie is probably there for name recognition and more money, but I don't see him winning anything.
No. But he does, I mean, in a blusterier way, he's expressing the same thing that the rest of them, Nikki Haley and all the rest, are saying.
Well, doesn't this also divert attention from far more serious matters here at home? It really does. What does it cost Christie to say, we have to beat those Russians? Nothing. Doesn't cost him anything. Costs the country a great deal in terms of money, prestige. What Fitch just downgraded our creditworthiness one more time. And people say, oh, it's not a problem. You know, the bond yields are on their way up. And prices are on their way down. When is the Treasury bond fire sale going to happen? When do banks offload these Treasury bonds that they bought when they were at zero interest because they're now worthless? What's going to happen in China, in Japan, in Saudi Arabia, where they have lots of bonds? I mean, we're fragile. We're vulnerable. Nobody even mentions it because nobody wants to fess up and tell the truth. We've overreached. We're running on fumes. What about this economy? What are we building? What are we producing? You know, that's what made us a great power between 1865 and basically 1920. That's when your industrial base was created. That's when you had people like Edison and Tesla, Rockefeller, all these people, they were tough and they were intelligent and they were effective. The only person I see out there now who's remotely like that is Musk. He's building something. He's creating something. When you do that, you create employment. I don't see that happening. High-tech startups? What the hell are they? What are they doing for us? A new app on your phone? We've got to wake up and say, oh, well, AI. AI is better algorithms. Better algorithms do not replace human beings. And they don't necessarily create opportunity for people to work. We've got to think this thing through very carefully. We haven't done that. We haven't. What about our energy sector? Oil, gas, we've killed it. We have what, half the refineries we once had? California had something in the neighborhood of 43 or 44 refineries. They're down to 23. You know, how long before suddenly we're in another energy crisis and we need to rapidly refine fuel? Can we do it? Well, the answer is it's going to be tough. The same thing applies to Raytheon. We want 200 missiles and we want them now. Well, we have no surge capacity. There's no excess capacity built into anything. What are we going to do with this scientific industrial base? What about our agricultural sector? What are we doing for that? High-end manufacturing is dead. We need to repatriate lots of industries. That's what President Trump talked about. We absolutely need to do that. People say, well, we want free trade. Well, I'm 100% for free trade as long as it doesn't kill us. But if it kills us, then I'm for protection. You know, I think we need to understand how we got where we are today. I don't see anybody talking about that. And I think Americans are beginning to turn these people off. You know, Democrats, Republicans, it's the Uniparty. Who are we kidding? What are they doing for us? The swamp gets bigger and richer. The rest of the country gets poorer. I don't see any good outcome right now from any of these candidates. Perhaps I'm too harsh, but that's the way I feel.
Last question, and it's more a piece of tape that I want to get you to respond to, but I think it's come to a lot of people's attention. This is just so perfect that one of the spokesmen for the Ukrainian military is an American guy, leftist, dressed up like a woman, who's now wearing a Ukrainian army uniform and talking about killing Putin. Watch this.
If you look at Putin's mouth, you'll notice that blood drips from it. He's a vampire carrying out genocide against both Ukrainians and Russians alike. Vlad Putin bathes in the blood of innocent children and enjoys it. And this is why the dictator of the Russian Federation must be deposed and why peace talks have to be focused on President Zelensky's 10-point peace formula and the full liberation of Ukraine.
There's something so perfect about that, the convergence of every ugly anti-human trend in modern
life. Is that a transgender person?
That's a guy with fake breasts,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, I think everything else is fake too. We estimate that at least 60,000 children from Ukraine have disappeared, vanished since this war began. Where are they? What about all of the women that have been sold into prostitution that once lived in Ukraine? This war is a catastrophe. The people bathing in blood are in Kiev and Washington, not in Moscow. And this sort of thing is going to play well until it can't. And that's the sad part. We're going to see this whole thing collapse and implode. It's coming.
And with it, NATO?
I would think so, because the Europeans right now, Germany is well into a recession. It has systematically deindustrialized itself by casting its lot with the anti-Russian crowd. And remember that in Europe, it was not very difficult to supply stereotypes left over from the Second World War of the Soviet armed forces. The Soviet army was, an exercise in barbarism and savagery, mass rape, you name it. It was
terrible.
That's not Russia today. Russia today is a very different society, very different state. And that's been Putin's effort from day one. He's been interested in restoring Russia as an Orthodox Christian state with a true national identity and a strong national culture. That's probably another reason why so many people want to destroy Russia. because it's the last European state that has not been flooded with foreigners and turned into some sort of polyglot experiment, which is failing badly, by the way, because at some point, all of these unwanted people in Europe, and for that matter, here as well, I suspect, when things fall apart economically, it's going to get very hard on them. Because people are going to look around and they go through this, well, wait a minute, I'm an American. Who are you? What are you doing here? Why are you living that way? Why are you being subsidized? I'm a German. You know, you don't belong here. You need to go home.
I'm getting $1,400 a month in retirement that I paid into my entire life. And you just show up from Congo and you're getting $2,200.
Well, here's another one. The president announced yesterday on one of these tweets, somebody tweets for him, obviously, that the people that have lost everything in Hawaii, thousands of them lost everything, are going to receive a one-time payment of $700. Now, I haven't been to Hawaii in a long time. I'm not even sure I've ever been there, but I know that $700 isn't going to take care of a family for very long.
No.
But in the meantime, hundreds of millions, billions of dollars continue to flow into this black hole called Ukraine, which I think is an exercise in fraud, deceit, and criminality, to be blunt. So when's it going to stop? When are we going to take care of Hawaii? Let's go back to Ohio, where we had the derailment and the chemical spill. 4,000 human beings living in this area. The water is still not fit to drink, as I understand it. We wouldn't even invest the money to move those people to a safer area, even if it meant temporary housing or permanent housing, until this thing was cleaned up. What have we done? This is the problem. It is America last on every level. The last people who are consulted, the last people who are benefiting from anything that goes on in Washington are Americans. This cannot go on. It's got to end. And I think it will end. But unfortunately, it's like everything else. We're going to have to be pushed over the cliff into the abyss. I think that's where we're headed.
Well, on that cheerful note, retired Colonel Douglas McGregor.
Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight. Sheila Jackson Lee is famous in Washington for being the single most obnoxious member of Congress. Now, that's a title that, as you can imagine, has many contenders. But Sheila Jackson Lee stands alone. "Don't you know who I am?" she once screamed at a flight attendant in the first class cabin on a Continental flight. "I am Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee. Where is my seafood meal?" In the 1990s, during a visit to NASA, Sheila Jackson Lee demanded to see the flag that astronauts had planted on Mars. When gently informed that no human being has ever been to Mars because it's very far away, Lee flew into a rage. She accused NASA of racism and pointed out her membership on the, quote, science committee in Congress, and so on. We could spend the entire hour on Sheila Jackson Lee stories, and it's tempting. On Capitol Hill, she's known as the Queen, and not in a good way. But what's interesting is that nobody ever talks about the congressional district that Sheila Jackson Lee supposedly represents. It's mostly inner city Houston, and it could use some help. Lee's district has a poverty rate almost twice the national average, with all the usual markers of civilizational decline: high crime, bad schools, low social cohesion, drugs. Now, Lee has, quote, served in Congress for nearly 30 years, but it's hard to think of a single thing she has ever done to improve the lives of the people who elected her. She doesn't seem interested. Instead, Sheila Jackson Lee has devoted her entire political career, indeed her entire life, to a single cause: shrieking about white racism. That's what Sheila Jackson Lee does for a living. Here's a selection.
"Institutional racism and systemic racism taints and spoils the way that America treats, in one instance, African Americans, and other instances, minorities.
The dastardly impacts of white nationalism, white supremacy, and outright racism. Racism is a national security threat.
Racism is a national security threat.
Racism is a national security threat.
Institutional racism does exist, and until we accept that, we will not finish our job.
We will not elect a chief bigot of the United States of America.
Our system is such that it then allows Americans, people, to act in instances in a racist manner."
Racism, you see, is a national security threat. It's a national security threat. Really, Sheila Jackson Lee?
Tell us how racism is a national security threat. Speak slowly. We've got plenty of time. But of course, she won't do that. She's got no argument. She's got no facts. She doesn't even have a sincere belief in what she's saying. It's absurd, and she knows it. And by the way, Sheila Jackson Lee doesn't want to protect a country she despises from national security threats. Why would she want to do that? No, that's not the point. What she's doing here every day is leveling a racial attack, a blood libel against an entire group of Americans while simultaneously pretending to be the victim of attacks from that same group. Stop hitting me, she howls as she punches you in the face. It's such a common tactic at this point, used constantly by Al Sharpton, by the ADL, by so many others, that you may not even notice it anymore. But it's still disgusting, it's still immoral, it's still divisive. Here's Joe Biden doing it.
And finally, we're confronting the stains of what remains a deep stain in the soul of the nation, hate and white supremacy. You know, there's a tough through line of subjugation of enslaved people from our earliest days to the reigns of radicalized terror, the KKK, to Dr. King being assassinated. And the violent, deadly insurrection on the Capitol 9 months ago, it was about white supremacy in my view.
Speaking of blood libel, because that's what it is, protesting the 2020 election results is the same as slavery, as the KKK. It's the same as murdering Martin Luther King. It's all white supremacy, declares Joe Biden without defining the term. Now, you may recall when Joe Biden said that. You probably dismissed it at the time as ridiculous, as the rantings of a senile partisan, and of course, that's what it was. But you should also keep in mind that Joe Biden did not say that by accident. It wasn't an ad lib off the cuff. No, his staff signed off on that speech. They wrote it, they read it before he read it. And they wrote it for a reason. When the president of the United States identifies a threat to this country, his many federal agencies, the biggest in the world, swing into action to neutralize that threat. That's how the system works, as Joe Biden's staff well knows. So in fact, when Joe Biden likens you to Al-Qaeda or the Klan, it's not a small thing at all. It has implications. So here's Sheila Jackson Lee from last week in a not unrelated clip calling for the renewal of the Patriot Act. Watch.
I remember after 9/11 when we all worked together to ensure the protection of the American people through the Patriot Act and dealing with the FISA courts. We worked together because truth is important.
Now, that's kind of strange if you think about it. So why would Sheila Jackson Lee, a self-described liberal, find herself last week praising the secret government courts that liberals once opposed passionately on the grounds that those courts could be used to destroy the constitutional rights of Americans without anyone knowing about it? Secret courts? Liberals were against secret courts, and now the chief liberal in Congress is strongly for secret courts. What's going on here? Why? Well, because those secret courts turn out to be a highly effective way to silence the critics of the Democratic Party, to silence those so-called white supremacists Joe Biden's always yelling about, not all of whom, by the way, are white. You don't have to be white to be a white supremacist. You just have to oppose the agenda. And of course, Sheila Jackson Lee knows that very well. And that's why she wants to renew the Patriot Act indefinitely. And there are enough dumb Republicans that she may be able to. But Sheila Jackson Lee would like to go a lot further than that. Lee has just introduced a bill called the Leading Against White Supremacy Act of 2023. Now, it's not an exaggeration to say this single bill would do more to criminalize speech, previously constitutionally guaranteed speech, than any other piece of legislation that has been proposed in the entire history of this country. That's not an overstatement at all, and to prove it, we're going to read directly from the bill. Here it is, quote, "A conspiracy to engage in white supremacy-inspired hate crime shall be determined to exist between two or more persons, at least one of whom published material advancing white supremacy, white supremacist ideology, antagonism based on, quote, replacement theory, or hate speech that vilifies or is otherwise directed against any non-white person or group," end quote. Now, nowhere in the legislation is the term white supremacy or white supremacist ideology ever defined. Of course, it's never defined. It's left open. It's subjective. Anything can be white supremacy. But the bill does specifically point to something called replacement theory, white supremacist ideology. If you engage in either one of them, you go to federal prison, possibly for a very long time. So all that's required under this piece of legislation, which has not been laughed out of Congress yet, all that's required is that your political opinions, quote, could, as determined by a reasonable person, motivate actions by a person predisposed to engaging in a white supremacy-inspired hate crime. So what would qualify as a felony under this law? Well, virtually everything. But among them would be pointing out that Democratic Party politicians, including Chuck Schumer, the leading Senate Democrat, have long bragged that they are flooding this country with immigrants in order to change the demography to maintain political power for themselves. They've said that many times. They've written it. They've bragged about it on camera. But if you notice it under this bill, you would be criminally responsible for the violent acts of people you have never met. And you would go to jail for terrorism. Now, what's most interesting about this bill is that it's race specific. Nothing in Sheila Jackson Lee's legislation would apply to, say, black supremacy or murder sprees by people who aren't white supremacists. The massacre in Waukesha, for example. So that means that Democratic Party politicians can continue to say whatever they want with impunity. The First Amendment still applies to them, but not to anyone who doesn't vote for them. So that's the definition of tyranny. It's horrifying. It's a direct attack on the Bill of Rights, on our core freedoms guaranteed by the U.S. government for 250 years. We shouldn't be surprised by this, however, because it's consistent with what Biden has promised. Has promised since the day he got into office. And the promise was that race-blind justice, which is the entire foundation of the rule of law in the West, has been for centuries, is done. The new model, South Africa. That's the new model, South Africa, a country we never talk about because no one wants to admit what's happened there over the past 29 years. But on the basis of that, Biden tried to allocate farm aid on the basis of skin color. A federal judge blocked that plan, but it has not stopped the Democratic Party because no one's repudiated the idea. No one on the right has been brave enough to say, no, the federal government can never award or punish on the basis of skin color. That is immoral and it's contrary to American law. And because no one has said that, Democrats, including Sheila Jackson Lee, have decided that their opponents are terrorists. And they're terrorists because of their race. And once you're a terrorist, what do we get to do to you? We get to take all your stuff. We get to seize your assets. It shouldn't surprise you that is actually unfolding in the state of California. Always the leading edge of lunacy. Watch this.
These economists have worked alongside us over this past year to come up with potential estimates for what reparations in the form of compensation or cash payments can look like for African Americans. That $500 billion number represents the state of California's maximum culpability for racist redlining practices. And that number represents the state of California's maximum liability. It is not a final recommendation coming out of the task force. Final recommendations do not come out until July 1 of 2023.
No, everything about this, of course, is bad and wrong, not just in practice, but in principle. But in practice, it sets up an incentive that the whole country is going to have to grapple with fairly soon. We've already been told that you can change your sex, your immutable characteristic, just by wishing it so. Men can become women, women can become men. Why then can't people change their race? That's a sincere question that is waved away as ridiculous, but it's not any more ridiculous than changing your sex. In fact, it's the same. So under laws like this, there is a huge incentive to change your race because you get paid for doing that. What are we going to do about that? But what's interesting and sadly, sadly predictable is that as politicians in California and the rest of the country decide how they're going to loot the treasury in the name of racial justice, the communities they supposedly serve are falling apart in real, tangible, measurable ways. People are dying. Axios, for example, reports that carjackings in D.C. have risen for the fifth straight year. Ask anyone who lives there. Ask the D.C. council candidate who was carjacked in broad daylight a year ago. Candace, and we're always happy to have her on the show tonight. Candace, thanks so much for coming on. So at the same time that they're, you know, addressing these big theoretical macro issues and changing the American Criminal Justice Code to be race specific, something it's never been, they're ignoring the collapse of daily life for their constituents. What, you see this everywhere. What is it?
We don't know what it is. It does seem to be a very strange collision. And seeing her put this forth is just actually, I'm incredulous. And selfishly, I'd like to see it go into place for maybe just one day, because it would be brilliant for Black conservatives, because every single Democrat would fall by their sword. Of course, they reserve their most hatred and the most vitriol for Black conservatives, people like myself, Larry Elder, Clarence Thomas. They'd all be locked up federally, trust you, if this actually gotten put into place. But I think it also yields more questions for me. I'm looking at this and I'm going, what are they possibly thinking? How would this work? What about Black on Black criticism? Would they lock me up for saying something like, you know, Sheila Jackson is fundamentally a low IQ, hateful individual? I'm just saying that I don't want to go to prison. I'm giving you a what if scenario. If I did say that, would I go to prison? And how is this going to run parallel to their decriminalization efforts, right? They don't want any Black and Brown people in prison. They want them all to be on the streets. But at the same time, they're saying that they will lock us up. And by the way, would this extend to an overseas policy? Would I be locked up if I said anything bad about the late Osama bin Laden? I mean, of course, this wasn't well thought through, but because it doesn't need to be. We know that their every effort is aimed at censoring speech, right? The Democrats know that in order for them to be omnipotent, they need to be able to control words, because if they can control words, they can control thoughts. And ultimately, what they're after is brainwash. And by the way, They've been really good at brainwash. Speaking of what you just spoke about, you have people that are graduating. I just talked about this today. Graduating Harvard, who actually believe that men can be women and women can be men, and all we have to do is change our minds. So they know exactly what they're doing. They know exactly what they're after. And ultimately, what they want is full power and control over every single person and their households.
And they'll use law enforcement to do it, and the police and the FBI and the courts. I wonder if we've laughed too much at the absurdity of all of this and not internalized how deadly serious they are about using power to crush their political opponents.
Oh, I have been laughing, but at the same time pointing people to the very real truth and said that what they truly want is a totalitarian society. They are following the playbook, you know, everything that they are after. They are attacking religion. They are attacking the First Amendment. They continually want to remove guns from your households. I mean, what does that spell out to you? Where have we seen this before? In every communist society that exists, that has existed and does exist today, because that is what needs to happen. They need to remove individual power. And what's been very interesting is seeing how they're breaking down people's mentality, right? We are becoming a fundamentally weak country. You have people that cry at the drop of a hat because they've been misgendered. Of course, they know that that these people are not going to be able to take them on in the future. You think these people are going to stand up to government when they can't even stand up to themselves and look themselves in the mirror and say, no, actually, I cannot be this person. I can't just wake up and say that I'm a man or that I'm a woman. So it's so Machiavellian, and it's so important that we keep talking about it. You can laugh to stay sane, but also recognize that something very real is happening in this country. And it's dangerous and it's sinister.
That could not have happened 5 years ago. That's exactly right. I couldn't agree more. Candace Owens, great to see you tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, here's a huge story that's getting pretty much no attention. So the FAA, which regulates commercial air travel, has quietly begun allowing a much wider range of heart abnormalities in pilots. People flying your plane are allowed to be a lot sicker than they were last year. Now, the FAA made this change after the COVID vax became mandatory. Obviously, this has enormous implications for aviation safety for the lives of Americans. And so some questions are in order. Why is this happening? Is the first one. That's straight ahead. One of the reasons that commercial air travel is so safe in this country is that the FAA has stringent guidelines for the health of pilots. And that's, of course, important. You don't want your pilot dying with a plane load full of passengers. And yet here's something pretty amazing that happened without much notice at all, without any explanation publicly. The FAA just made a major change in the health requirements for pilots with heart damage. The FAA has significantly broadened the acceptable EKG range for commercial pilots. Steve Kirsch reported this on his Substack. Now, the change now allows people with injured hearts, cardiac injury, to fly. Now, the FAA made this change last October, just after the vaccines were rolled out and made mandatory. Why? Well, we reached out to the FAA today for an explanation. They claim they, quote, follow standard processes based on data and science, whatever that means. Lieutenant Colonel Teresa Long is an Army flight surgeon. She joins us tonight to assess. Doctor, thank you so much for coming on. So this you know, raise some red flags, I would say, for people, given what's at stake in commercial air travel. Why do you think the FAA did this?
Thank you for having me on, Tucker. I just want to say upfront that my opinions are my own and they do not reflect that of the United States Army or the DOD.
Yes.
So why they made the change is very obscure, because extending the PR interval from the acceptable range of 120 to 200 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds does not improve safety. And I would like to see the data and the research that they based that decision on. In aviation, we are a data-driven institution, and everything centers around risk mitigation. So making that broader actually puts the public at greater risk of a pilot having a cardiac event that didn't get caught because they've extended that range.
So, I mean, that's inexplicable. Everything the FAA does, as you just said, has to be designed with one goal in mind, and that's the safest possible flight. Commercial, military pilot, I mean, and pilots think that way. So there is no way, in your opinion as a flight surgeon, that this change, whatever its cause, could make air travel safer.
No, and in light of the emerging and overwhelming data that is showing the cardiac damage from COVID and the COVID vaccines on cardiac muscle, I can't imagine why they would make this move. And I think it's a question that really should be taken to Dr. Susan Northrup. She's the senior flight surgeon for the FAA, and ask what data they use to support this. And I think it only undermines aviation safety. If you realize that in the military, pilots receive an EKG every year, whereas for commercial air, they receive it at 35 and then at 40 and every year annually after age 40. So those are, you know, very, we hardly see them to begin with in terms of, you know, a 5-year gap in there. And
right.
So.
Right. So, I mean, this is baffling. I'm sorry, I think there's an audio delay, but let me just say I appreciate your confirming what seems like common sense, that there's no good answer for why they're doing this. And we are going to follow up Dr. Teresa Long and ask to interview the head flight surgeon at FAA, because maybe we're missing something. Doesn't sound like it, though. Thank you for joining us tonight.
Yeah, thank you, Tucker.
Thank you. So you may have seen this video, an Amazon delivery driver in Apple Valley, California, dropping off packages when he steps and falls inside a septic tank. It happened last week. While he was stuck, the driver uploaded this video.
Scary.
So the fire department did come and rescue that man. And here's the thing, at a moment when people are dismissing American workers as lazy or disengaged, that man took a shower and then continued his route. And we were very impressed with that. In fact, we gave him the Employee of the Month honors, and then we found him. His name is Charles Amicangelo. He joins us tonight. Charles, I'm so impressed with this. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you,
Tucker. Fell into this like a tiger trap without seeing it. Is that correct?
No, actually, I did see the hole. I walked by it on my way to deliver a package, and then I walked by it again on my way back to my vehicle, and the ground next to the hole is what collapsed underneath me. Even though I kept a bit of a distance from the hole, I still managed to fall in because of the ground collapsing under my feet. And also, I wanted to let you know, the fire department confirmed with me the drop wasn't 6 feet, it was actually 13 feet.
That's unbelievable. So, I mean, I'm sure you see all kinds of things on your route every day. I mean, it's, you know, famously a pretty interesting job. Weird people, dogs. Have you ever fallen into a deep hole before?
This is not something I would have ever imagined happened, no, Tucker. And I don't think other delivery drivers would have either.
Your coolness under pressure inspires the rest of us. but also your commitment to your job. I mean, once you fall into a 13-foot septic hole, I mean, you kind of deserve the day off. I mean, people take holidays off I've never heard of before. Did you consider just calling it a day and having a beer?
I did consider it. You know, I think there was several things that caused me to decide to go ahead and finish the route. And, you know, it was probably, I was on a good adrenaline rush. You know, my time in the Marine Corps, you know, as a Marine, you know, we're conditioned to always accomplish our mission, you know, so that was going through my head. But another big thing is that had I not completed my route, or attempted to at least, other drivers who had already been out there and done their entire routes would get stuck having to finish my route, and I just didn't think that would be fair to them either. But I did voluntarily offer to take my route, so.
I hope you're rewarded for it. You certainly have our admiration for it. Charles McAngelo, thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you, Tucker.
So impressive.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So it looks like, and there's not a ton of debate about this actually, that Sam Bankman-Fried committed what is probably the largest financial fraud in history. Now, while a lot of people from January 6th are still in jail for trespassing, Sam Bankman-Fried is not in jail tonight. And here's the best part. You're still not allowed to know who bailed him out. Why can't you know that? We looked into it. We'll tell you what we found straight ahead. There's a Sherpa for us as we tried to understand what was happening with Sam Bankman-Fried. It's with Vivek Ramaswamy, a frequent guest on the show, executive chairman of Strive Asset Management. He joins us in studio tonight. Vivek, thanks so much for coming on. I loved your point, and I think it's one of the truest guides to other people's talking. But tell me why Sam Bankman-Fried seems to be treated so much more gently than your average criminal defendant.
Well, it's because he had the entire deflection tactic set up, and it wasn't just the jargon. It was the ESG smokescreen. It was the good guy who was engaged in effective altruism, funding Democratic candidates. He knew how to play the game to be able to create the appearance that he cared about something other than profit and power, when in fact he cared only about more profit and power for himself. But the thing that was most striking to me about the story, Tucker, is not how this is some sort of deviant who's so different than how the rest of Wall Street operates, but how familiar his story really is. It is the same story as we saw back in 2008. I think there are a lot of similarities. It's going to make a lot of people mad to hear this. There's a lot of similarities to what those ESG promoting financial institutions do today. Because what did SBF do? He took client funds without their permission and used it to advance his agenda without telling him. Guess what the largest financial institutions in the world are doing today? They're using somebody else's money without their permission to advance their own agendas. And so what I find most fascinating about the story isn't this one guy with curly hair who's 30 years old that was worth a lot of money and now isn't. That's just a detail. I think it's an interesting moment for everyone to look in the mirror who's in Wall Street and everywhere else and ask themselves how dissimilar his story really is to what even mainstream actors in financial markets have been doing since 2008.
It's a wise point. I mean, these are people who are motivated by a lot of things, but one of them is the desire to accumulate as much money as possible. We know that. It's fine. But we have regulators who are supposed to keep that within the bounds, like Gary Gensler. Where are they?
They're busy focused on advancing those same agendas, right? Why are they propagating ESG disclosure rules when, in fact, they should be focused on preventing people from losing money? Right? You would think this was an objective. And the irony is they're going to use this as a catalyst to say, well, now we need to have greater purview over regulating cryptocurrencies or whatever. When in fact, this is just a managerial class that's advancing a political agenda. And the more you advance a political agenda, the less you're doing the job that you're actually supposed to do. And you know it well, Tucker, that is the story of the administrative state, the SEC included, as we know it.
So just really quick, if it is true that what Sam Bankman-Fried did is not so different from what a lot of people are doing right now, are you concerned about the stability of our financial system?
So look, I've had concerns dating back to 2008. The thing that we didn't let happen in this country, Tucker, was when those banks actually erred back then, we should have let them fall and actually teach this system its lesson. Instead, the lesson we taught was the worse you act, the more likely you are to get bailed out by the system.
Totally right.
SBF was a young guy. That's the system he grew up. What else do you expect but a next generation of fraudsters do the same thing a decade and a half later?
And clearly his parents encouraged this. I mean, you can just imagine this kid pulling the same scam at 13. You know,
yeah,
oh, isn't he cute? He's so smart. Okay. Vivek, great to see you. Thank you
for your very
crisp analysis. So a teenage girl in California was showering recently at a YMCA when a naked man entered the locker room. And the YMCA didn't seem to care. Now that teen girl is taking action. She joins us straight ahead.
As I was showering after my workout, I saw a naked male in the women's locker room. I immediately went back into the shower, terrified, and hid behind their flimsy excuse for a curtain until he was gone.
We're going to show you a video that sums up the reality of trans activism. Not the theory, not the slogans, the reality for actual people, including young people. This video shows a teenage girl called Rebecca speaking to the Santee City Council in California about her experience at a YMC locker room. She was taking a shower when a naked man walked in. Watch.
As I was showering after my workout, I saw a naked male in the women's locker room. I immediately went back into the shower, terrified, and hid behind their flimsy excuse for a curtain until he was gone. As I did so, I could only think of my 5-year-old sister, who I bring to this gym during the summer to enjoy their water slides. This is the YMCA, where hundreds of children spend their summer afternoons in childcare camps. When I asked the YMCA management what their policy was regarding transgenders, they confirmed that the man that I saw was indeed allowed to shower wherever he pleased. As long as you are not a red flag on Megan's Law, the California Sex Offender Registry, a grown male can shower alongside a teenage girl at your YMCA location here in Santee.
Of course, you should be on the Sex Offender Registry for showering with teenage girls if you're an adult man. YMCA should be ashamed of itself. Of course, it's not. They just put out a statement saying they're, quote, reviewing their floor plans. We wanted to speak to the young woman you just saw in that video. We found her. Her name is Rebecca, and we're grateful to have her join us tonight. Rebecca, thank you so much for coming on. You're not the only person this happened to. You're one of the only people who said anything about it. Why did you decide you would take the risk of speaking up about this?
Well, I mean, when I addressed the city council, I didn't even know that I was being recorded. I had no idea that it was going to get this nationwide response. But I just felt like it was my duty to shed light on the consequences of these policies, because people need to realize that the things that we were thinking could happen are now actually happening in normal everyday situations to normal people.
Well, that's exactly. How old are you, by the way?
I'm 17.
It's amazing that you had the courage to do this and the ability to describe it so vividly, which you did. I'm so impressed by that. What kind of response did you get?
Yeah, well, I mean, from the media, it's largely been very positive, because people are realizing that this is happening in their neighborhoods. This is happening in their backyards, and parents and children, women, are outraged by this. So largely, it's been a good response. And the YMCA has informed me that they're going to look into changing some things, but they keep pointing to local policies and local laws as kind of an excuse as to why they have this transgender law. So we haven't seen any reaction to change the policy of the YMCA. They've just said that they're looking into it, but I'm excited to see what they'll do further, because something practical and something tangible does need to be done here.
Yeah, I doubt they'll do anything unless forced to, and I certainly hope they are. So we've been hearing that the transgender activism is empowering. Did you feel empowered as a teenage girl when a naked man walked into your shower room?
No, not at all. My safety, my privacy was threatened. I mean, I had just been in the shower, so I'm in one of the most vulnerable positions that a girl can be in. I'm getting out, and I see this man's backside. So not only do I not want to see him, but I was terrified that he was going to see me. So I went right back into the shower, and no, this is absolutely not empowering whatsoever. In our efforts to cater to the rights of transgenders to express themselves, it's threatening my safety, my privacy, and also the safety and privacy of all the other women and children who are frequenting that YMCA.
Bless you for saying that out loud. It's shocking that it requires bravery to say it, but we both know that it does. So thank you. Rebecca, good to see you tonight.
Well, thank you for having me.
Of course. So the former NBA player Enes Kanter Freedom was in Rome recently when he learned from the FBI that he needed to come back to the U.S. immediately. He was told that the Turkish government had put a bounty on his head. Freedom grew up in Turkey before coming to the United States and changing his name in honor of this country. He's been critical of the Turkish government. Enes Kanter Freedom joins us tonight. Thanks so much for coming on. So the Turkish government, you were informed, but the U.S. government has put a bounty on your head, $500,000 bounty. What does that mean, a bounty on your head?
So, like, first of all, thank you for having me, Mr. Carlson. I was doing a basketball camp in Vatican, actually, for, you know, Christians, Catholic, Muslim, and Jewish kids. And I heard the news for the first time, and I got in touch with FBI immediately, and they said, come back to America at this moment. So I took a flight the next day, and so, you know, this is the first time actually the Turkish government put a bounty on my head and put me in a most wanted terrorist list. Just because of I talk about the, some of the human rights violations and political opinions that is happening in Turkey. And, you know, I'm not the only one. There are so many journalists, academics, professors, and celebrities are on that list. And when I had a conversation with my friends on the ground, they said, the mafia, the serial killers actually, professional hitmen and cartel could be after my case. And I was like speechless. I was like, this cannot be happening to an American citizen in U.S. soil.
Do you feel like the U.S. government is helping to protect you from this threat from a foreign government? Yeah.
Really good question. You know, some of the members of the Congress actually reacting to this news and asking Biden administration to speak up and actually take some actions, you know, because I remember first time President Biden, before he took to office, actually, the first thing he said, the problem in Middle East is Erdogan and we need to do something about it. And it's been almost 2 years and he has not done a thing yet. So we have to prioritize human rights because Turkey plays a very important role because it could be the bridge of Islam and West, but just because of there is no freedom of speech, you know, there are so many political prisoners and innocent people are in the jail waiting for help, it is not possible. So I'm asking, please, Biden administration to take some solid actions and help my friends over there, help my family over there. I haven't seen them almost 10 years.
Well, if they're okay with Chinese genocide, I doubt they're going to be too upset about Erdogan, but that's just a guess. Hope I'm wrong. Ina Skinner, great to see you tonight. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And we will be right back. Mispronouncing Kamala Harris's name isn't just embarrassing, it's racist, as we found out. Hasn't prevented a lot of people from doing it, including Kamala herself. Today, Joe Biden tried to pronounce her name. Here's what happened.
But as Kamala said, we're all closely monitoring the storms, the floods, the landslides all across California.
Kamala? I thought it was Kamala. We're going with Carmela, splitting the difference. Carmela Harris, ladies and gentlemen, our vice president. Well, that's it for us. Unfortunately, we'd love to spend a little more time getting to the etymology of the name Kamala, Kamala, Carmela. Who thought that up? But we don't have any time left. Have the best night with the ones you love. We will see you tomorrow. Happy Wednesday. Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight. So if you've been paying attention for the past 5 or 6 years, and we know you have been, you've probably noticed the inverted nature of modern language. Pretty much everything is precisely the opposite of what they claim it is. So the people who tell you they're defending democracy are promoting authoritarianism, which is not democracy. Then the Black Lives Matter movement winds up killing black people. Who would have seen that coming? Then our public health authorities make the population sicker. And this is our new favorite, the so-called World Economic Forum seems to exist to destroy national economies. Not an overstatement. It was the WEF, keep in mind, that told the government of Sri Lanka to give up modern fertilizer. Oh, good plan, guys. Go ahead and try it. Result? The country collapsed and people starved. Then it was the WEF that promoted Sam Bankman-Fried's historic Ponzi, the biggest financial fraud in history. Apparently, the savants at the World Economic Forum just couldn't tell that this twitchy, pill-popping kid in cargo shorts, who literally played video games during interviews, was an utterly transparent scammer. They had no idea. They thought he was a genius, just like them. And of course, it was the WEF that predicted the COVID lockdowns would, quote, quietly improve cities, not turn them into ominous hellscapes of unemployment, drug addiction, and crime. It seemed like a good plan at the time. Hey, I've got an idea. Let's prevent people from working. That'll make them rich. It'll quietly improve life for everyone. That's the World Economic Forum for you. The WEF is often described as a group of supervillains, but they're also hilariously idiotic. Not just evil, buffoonish. And by the way, they know it. They're smart enough to be embarrassed anyway. The WEF has since deleted its tweet about COVID lockdowns. It has memory-holed its promotion of scammer Sam Bankman-Fried. It has conveniently forgotten all about its guidance on Sri Lankan fertilizer, on which it turns out the WEF is not an expert. None of that ever happened. The slate is clean. So we're ready for yet another World Economic Forum annual meeting in Davos, Switzerland, which is underway right now. The event kicked off this week with 84-year-old Klaus Schwab, he's the founder of the WEF, promising to, quote, master the future.
We couldn't meet at a more challenging time. We are confronted with so many crises simultaneously. What does it need to master the future? I think to have a platform where all stakeholders of global society are engaged.
We must master the future. Master the future. So mastering the future is now the top item on the to-do list at the World Economic Forum this year. That's the first clue. These people are not living the same life you are. By the end of this week, you hope to find some time to get an oil change or maybe pick up some dandruff shampoo at Rite Aid. At the World Economic Forum, they plan to master the future. That's the kind of people they are. How are they going to do it, by the way? Well, they're going to do it with John Kerry, who, despite physical appearances, is still alive. Kerry will be 80 years old this year, so it goes without saying that if he's going to master the future, he'd better hurry. Thankfully, he's got a plan. Watch.
It's pretty extraordinary that we, select group of human beings, because of whatever touched us at some point in our lives, are able to sit in a room and come together and actually talk about saving the planet. I mean, it's so almost extraterrestrial to think about, quote, saving the planet. And if you said that to most people, they think you're just a crazy tree-hugging, lefty, liberal, you know, do-gooder, whatever, and there's no relationship. But really, that's where we are.
So, most people don't understand, but we are a select group of human beings, John Kerry tells the attendees of the World Economic Forum, who honestly did not need to be reminded of that. People may say we're crazy, tree-hugging, liberal do-gooders, but we know the truth, which is that actually we're soulless, greed-head money worshippers who'd sell our own children to China for a big enough tax credit. Shout out to you, Larry Fink, in the third row. Catch you at the sushi bar. That was John Kerry's message at the World Economic Forum, which is also effectively the WEF's credo. But then John Kerry went further. What we're doing today, he said, in saving the planet is almost, quote, extraterrestrial. In other words, if you ever suspected these people are freaking aliens, it turns out you're right. They are. And as if to prove it, Al Gore himself showed up. At 74 years old, Al Gore is as awkward, synthetic, and weird as he has ever been since eighth grade to now. Though at this point, he's much, much richer thanks to Google stock. Ever notice how the richer people get, the more they seem like Bill Gates? It's not your imagination. Al Gore single-handedly proves that theory. Here he was today.
Look at the xenophobia and political authoritarian trends that have come from just a few million refugees. What about a billion? We would lose our capacity for self-governance on this world. We have to act.
Always angry, always shouting. Fatter, but still grumpy. They're climate refugees now. They're climate refugees, millions of them. They're not economic migrants fleeing the squalor of Tegucigalpa for the generous social services of El Paso. No, they're not. They're climate refugees who have no choice but to risk their lives with coyotes because you drive a full-size Silverado. Illegal immigration is your fault, Middle America. It's not our fault. We got nothing to do with it. We just run the world. If this is all starting to sound like a bad CNN segment to you, a parade of self-confident dumb people, rich in self-esteem, low in wisdom, giving moralizing lectures to one another's applause, well, let us confirm that for you. Where was Don Lemon? Why wasn't he there? Well, he wasn't. That's on next year's program, no doubt. This year, we're not making this up, America's favorite unemployed media critic, Mr. Brian Stelter, ladies and gentlemen, watch.
The clear and present danger of disinformation is our conversation here this afternoon. It follows a session just now about disrupting distrust. And of course, those are connected. So I hope that's where we can start. I'm Brian Stelter, formerly of CNN, now a fellow at Harvard University. A reminder that the hashtag is WEF23. We can try to put some real information out into the world to make up for all the crazy.
Make up for all the crazy. The conclusion this year at the World Economic Forum is that people who are not at the World Economic Forum have too much free speech, too many bad ideas, too much crazy, and too much opportunity to talk. They're still talking out there. Stop them before they talk some more. So if you're getting the impression that the world's most mediocre people and least self-aware people are all congregating in Switzerland this week, you are on to something. In fact, it might be worth getting an attendee list just to make certain that not a single person who is there this week ever has power over you in any way. If one of these people shows up supervising the bake sale at your kid's school, call the police. They're not qualified. So with that in mind, it was interesting to see Florida Congresswoman Maria Salazar there. Maria Salazar hasn't been in Congress very long, but she has spent her time laser focused on helping foreign nationals come to this country illegally. Her own constituents, no concern. People in other countries coming here to go on welfare, oh yeah. Before Maria Salazar was even inaugurated, she posted a video on Twitter promising Nicaraguans and Hondurans in Central America that she would, quote, be there for them, to, quote, help and assist in, quote, everything the American government can do for them. Not what they might do for our country as new immigrants, how they might build the country, make it better, unite it, make it more prosperous, peaceful. No. What the American government can do for people the American government owes nothing to who are breaking laws the American government passed. That's Maria Salazar. She's in Davos this week, of course. And during her time in Davos, it goes without saying, she demanded amnesty for tens of millions of foreign nationals living in our country illegally. Watch.
We need to also give dignity to those people who are in the country. And those are the people that I represent. We're talking about 13, 15 million people who are, most of them, Hispanics. I would say 85% who speak my language, look like me, and sound like me, that are contributing with the economy of this country, and they live in the shadows. So it's time to seal the border, like she said. Put order, let's see who comes in and who doesn't, and then turn around and give dignity. That doesn't mean path to citizenship. That means to include them and make them dignified members of our community.
Millions of people who look like me. Don't you love it when white people pretend that the people streaming across our border look like me? Sorry, Maria Salazar, you are whiter than I am. So knock it off. It's false. And by the way, you don't represent foreign nationals in the United States here legally. You represent Americans because you're a representative of the American government. Donald Trump went to the Economic Forum in Davos some years ago and made it really clear that he represents, as the American president, Americans, not people from foreign countries living in the United States illegally. Now, a person who claims to be in his party is making exactly the opposite claim. Maria Salazar has been on this show before. We'd love to have her on again. That offer remains open always. In the meantime, Charlie Hurt is the opinion editor of the Washington Times. He joins us tonight. Charlie Hurt, so if you go on any social media that conservatives frequent, the World Economic Forum is reviled, but also described as all-powerful and diabolical. But when you see it on video, it seems maybe more ridiculous than anything else. These people seem stupid.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, the only thing that the RNC should be asking is what RNC chairman could get Davos moved to like October before every election, because it would be so much more effective in America if people would go into the voting booth with this stuff fresh in their mind. And, you know, it's easy to sort of pinpoint, you know, look at people like this, that Lex Luthor guy, or, you know, the most distrusted name in news, CNN anchor eunuch, going over there talking about what's truth and what's not truth. But the two most appalling people over there, if you ask me, are Al Gore and John Kerry. And these are two people who have been thoroughly, repeatedly rejected by American voters. And they have never gotten over it. And I think there's a special agony for these people because they were beaten by George W. Bush. And it has caused them to hate America. They hate democracy and they hate people. And that's why they're attracted to some slime nest like this Davos thing. That's why they go over there. And the hurt that is in them will never be cured. There are no number of back rubs that will ever cure Al Gore's pain or enough wealthy widows in the world that will fix John Kerry's pain.
I know.
These people despise humans, and that's why they congregate at outfits like this.
Well, it's discredited by definition because they've made mistakes and they've never apologized. I mean, we make mistakes. Yep. We told our viewers that all these Republicans were going to win in the midterms, and we were completely wrong, and we apologized for it because you're required to apologize when you're wrong. They told Sri Lanka to stop using fertilizer. They claimed the lockdowns would help economies. They bought the Sam Bankman-Fried BS parade, and they never apologized. Why don't they just say we were wrong? Like, why is that so hard?
Because to them, it has nothing to do with truth. It has to do with power. And to admit that you were wrong about something would suggest that you actually give a crap about one of these places where they are wrecking the economy or wrecking the food supply. But here's the most important thing, and you said this in your opening. This is the most important thing. There is only one entity in the world. There's only one power in the world that can stand up to these people, and that's America. And that's American voters. And every American voter who is outraged, who finds these people disgusting, ridiculous, yes. But they also have, you know, and you know, Joe Biden just let it slip this past weekend, talking about how, oh, you want your AR-15s? Yeah, well, we have F-15s. And, you know, you can take your AR-15s, but we're going to carpet bomb your farms in Tennessee, pal. That's what he said. And that's what these people all believe in. They all believe in that stuff. Military power is all they care about at the end of the day. And the only people in the world who will stand up to these people are American voters. Get involved at the local level. And make sure that our voice is heard over there, and these people are stood up to, because we're the only hope in the world against these people.
When they started taking over every institution in American life that's heavily armed, that should have been a tip off that they had malicious intent, because good people don't do that. Charlie Hurt, great to see you tonight. Thank you.
Great to see you.
A Fox News alert and some rare good news. The appalling Prime Minister of New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern, that's the lady with the big teeth who tormented her citizens, has just announced she is leaving office. Here she was moments ago.
Announcing that I will not be seeking re-election and that my term as Prime Minister will conclude no later than the 7th of February.
Most authoritarian leader that country has ever had, and no one else comes close. An appalling abuser of human rights of her own people. She, of course, earned the admiration of Western leaders, including former CIA director Michael Hayden, by ushering in an era of near totalitarianism in New Zealand. She shut down the entire country over a single COVID case. She told everyone to stay in their bubbles. She told citizens to inform on their neighbors by calling the police if they saw them outside. I'm not making this up, by the way. We kept a video record. Here's some of it.
Stay local and do not congregate. Don't talk to your neighbors. Please keep to your bubbles. It comes down again to those very simple principles. We know from overseas cases of the Delta variant that it can be spread by people simply walking past one another. So keep those movements outside to the bare minimum. You can now see family and friends again in their homes and use the bathroom inside. Luxury.
What are the chances she was a puppet of the Chinese government? We don't have enough evidence to prove that, but we would rate that as about 100% likely. Fortunately, there is a tiny shred of democracy left in New Zealand. Ardern's party was becoming very unpopular, so before she could lose, she's quitting. Woke culture is poisoning young people all over the world. One podcast host had the courage to make that point in a speech that is being shared all over the internet. If you have electricity, you've probably seen it this week. He joins us next.
We know that the way to improve the world is to work, is to create, it is to build.
This is a Fox News alert. The New York Post is reporting tonight that the crowds of prostitutes who have flooded into Davos, Switzerland, to service the sad elderly men who falsely believe they run the world,
have upped their prices and that some of these prostitutes are charging up to $2,500. That means at least somebody's benefiting from the World Economic Forum. Well, you may have seen this video online. It is everywhere. Recently, the Oxford Union, the debating society in Oxford, England, held a debate on wokeness. And from out of nowhere, a podcast host and comedian called Constantine Kissin defied the odds and won over the audience on a college campus with force and brilliance. And if you're wondering how he did it, here's how.
This country is responsible for 2% of global carbon emissions, which means that if Britain was to sink into the sea right now, it would make absolutely no difference to the issue of climate change. You know why? Because the future of the climate is going to be decided in Asia and in Latin America by poor people who couldn't give a about saving the planet. 120 million people in China do not have enough food. I don't mean that they don't get dessert. I mean they suffer from malnutrition. That means that their immune system is breaking down because they don't have enough food. You're not going to get them to stay poor. And the only thing that wokeness has to offer in exchange is to brainwash bright young minds like you to believe that you are victims, to believe that you have no agency, to believe that what you must do to improve the world is to complain, is to protest, is to throw soup on paintings. We know that the way to improve the world is to work, is to create, it is to build. And the problem with woke culture is that it's trained too many young minds like yours to forget about that.
Now, you'll notice if you watch that video that he's not reading that. There's no teleprompter. He's ad-libbing that whole thing. That is right off the top of his head. That's not easy. Constantine Kissin is the co-host of the Trigonometry podcast. He joins us. Sure appreciate your coming on. I think the video of your remarks at the Oxford Union has been shared more than, you know, anything on social media in the U.S. in a long time. How was the response to what you said?
It was great. I think people really enjoyed it. And I think it's partly because people are fed up of wokeness, as of course you know. But I think also there's another thing going on, Tucker. We live in a society in which adults are afraid of children and young people in particular. And so when you see somebody who is an adult talking to young people and being straight with them and saying, look, if you care about certain issues in the world, if you care about climate change or racial injustice or whatever, whining and complaining is not going to fix that problem. That we need young people to step up and actually work and build and create things. And as I said in the speech, to create the technology and the science that is going to help solve all the problems of the future. So I think that's one of the reasons it's gone so viral. And the feedback has been incredible. I really haven't received any negative feedback at all. It's been very, very positive. So I'm very grateful for that.
Well, we're grateful to see it because, I mean, first of all, you made a rational, fact-based case, which is always assuring to see. It's wonderful to see someone making an argument, and you did. But it's the first time in a long time I've seen somebody directly challenge the prevailing view on campus and not get shouted down. How did that happen?
Well, as you say, I think I made a rational argument. And I think this is the thing that I've been thinking about a lot. You know, we spoke a few years ago, and as a comedian, I was concerned about the erosion of free speech and the censorship, particularly in this country, in the UK. But as we've interviewed people in Trigonometry, as we've spoken to some of the greatest minds, you know, the Jordan Petersons of the world and many others, what I've started to realize is that this ideology, wokeness, is fundamentally anti-human. And the narrative goes something like this. You know, we are evil, particularly Westerners, especially, you know, straight white men like you, but actually all of us are evil and we must be punished. And that's why some of the solutions that we're being offered to the issue of climate change don't seem to make much sense. I don't really see how making pensioners in Britain freeze to death over the winter is going to solve the problem of climate change, or indeed impoverishing people in India and China. And I think actually we've got to believe that young people are persuadable. We've got to make rational arguments to them. And that is, I think, the way to deal with many of these problems. We've got to challenge young people to step up and be better.
We have to believe that young people are persuadable. And I think a lot of us in the elderly community, or near elderly, are losing confidence in that. But you believe it to be true, having just had this experience.
I do, and I think we all have to embrace that approach. I think we're not going to get anywhere by chastising people. We have to try and persuade them. I think that we've got to remember, Tucker, they're young minds. We were all young once, and we were just as idiotic and stubborn and so sure of ourselves that we thought we knew everything. I think we got to fight. We got to fight to change people's minds, and the way to do that is with rational argument and encouraging critical thinking, which is what I hope my speech has done.
Yes. I remember as a young man, I was very impressed by and persuaded by people who had forceful ideas they could clearly and rationally express. And I'm glad to see there are still people like that, because you did that. Constantine Kissin, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me, Tucker.
So what is happening in the National Hockey League? There's no reason the NHL should go crazy woke. Its fans aren't woke, that's for sure. Its players aren't. Most of its owners aren't. But the people who run the NHL certainly are. One player is being attacked for sticking to his religious beliefs by refusing to participate in the league's Pride Night. More on that next. Safety is a secondary concern, and that's obvious. There have been in recent days multiple serious, very potentially dangerous incidents at JFK Airport in New York. Fox's Trace Gallagher has been tracking these. He joins us tonight. Hey, Trace.
Hey, Tucker, and regardless of who's to blame, having two unusual incidents almost back-to-back at a major airport is an alarm bell ringer. Today, a JetBlue plane filled with passengers was pushing back from the gate when it struck the tail section of another empty JetBlue plane parked at a gate. The incident was not life-threatening, but it comes just a few days after what could have been a disastrous collision. Air traffic control tapes show that a Delta 737 heading to the Dominican was taking off on runway 4 left. An American Airlines 777 heading to London was given clearance to cross runway 31 left. Instead, the American plane crossed runway 4 left. And the Delta pilot, now going 105 miles per hour, was told frantically by air traffic control to abort the takeoff. The Delta pilot slammed on the brakes, clearly forcing every passenger on board to lunge forward. The Delta plane stopped 1,000 feet short of the American plane, but imagine, at 105 miles per hour, 1,000 feet is a few seconds. And a pilot I spoke with says there is no way the Delta flight would have been able to get airborne in time to avoid a collision. So big time save here by the air traffic controller. In the past 2 years, runway incursions across the U.S. have risen significantly, though it's unclear exactly why. And remember, the deadliest aviation incident ever was a runway collision in Tenerife, Spain, back in 1977. Two 747s collided, killed 583 people. Tucker.
Unbelievable. Trace Gallagher, thank you so much.
You bet.
Trace is available for your viewing edification every weeknight, midnight Eastern, on Fox News at night. So you cannot let civilization slip away. Civilization is marked by order and safety and peace and cleanliness. When it degrades, things become dirty and chaotic and crazy. And the Biden administration is accelerating that. But you see it everywhere. So the National Hockey League probably got the most conservative fan base in all big-time professional sports. But lately, under the NHL commissioner, the very highly paid NHL commissioner, the left-wing Gary Bettman, the league has been pushing left-wing politics on its fans and players. The NHL even tried to host a career conference in Florida that's only open to minorities. In other words, it's somehow bad when white men play hockey. Governor DeSantis stopped that because it's obviously racist and crazy. Last night, the NHL hosted something called Pride Night at the Wells Fargo Center in Philadelphia. Players were told, commanded, to wear rainbow jerseys to signal their allegiance to the gender cult. But one player refused to do that, Ivan Provorov. He's the Philadelphia Flyers defenseman. So reporters were deeply offended. You must wear the jersey. Why aren't you wearing the jersey? Everyone's wearing the jersey. Here's what he said.
I respect everybody, and I respect everybody's choices. My choice is to stay true to myself and my religion. That's all I'm going to say.
Why do you keep that by your religion?
Russian Orthodox.
Hero. Jason Whitlock, our old friend, is the host of Fearless. He joins us tonight. Jason, thanks so much for coming on. I respect everybody. I respect everybody's choices. And this is my choice because this is my religion. You would think that the rest of the country, including its press corps, would stand back in awe of the bravery of that man and the clarity of that sentiment, which is the true American sentiment. But people hate him for it. What's going on here?
Well, you would also think that more American-born and bred athletes of Christian faith would right. take a similar stand as this exactly. Russian guy, but were cowards. And it's hard to blame the NHL. This is all of corporate America imposing right. its will on sports leagues. All of corporate America has bought into diversity, inclusion, and equity, or diversity, equity, inclusion, whatever you want to call it. And so they have the corporate America has all these policies in place to impose diversity, equity, and inclusion. And now they're imposing that on the sports world. And so it's not just the National Hockey League, it's the NFL, it's Major League Baseball, it's the NBA. If someone tells you, hey, we're having a pride night and we don't care what your religious values are, put on this shirt, support this, they're all going to do it in lockstep because they're all slaves to corporate America. And so we have, the left has realized that the one institution, the one strong force in popular culture that instilled and reinforced conservative values has been the sports world, and they're using corporate America to take over the sports world and make it bend to the will of the left and the secular and the godless. And the NHL is just another example of this. They hired, or they announced the hiring of Black woman Kim Davis to be basically in charge of their diversity, equity, and inclusion program, and they're going to fix diversity in the National Hockey League. And fixing diversity in the National Hockey League means giving every team a diversity, inclusion, and equity department and slapping T-shirts on the players and making them support the LGBT agenda and the Black Lives Matter agenda and any agenda that stands against traditional American values.
Saddest observation of the week, that it took a foreigner to do this. You know, there's still a lot of Americans who play hockey, and it's inconceivable that any of them would say a single word about this. I mean, where's their self-respect?
Tucker, it's so crystal clear. Black Lives Matter is part of the LGBT movement. It's part of a Marxist movement. And so we've had athletes in football, basketball, baseball, everywhere. They're all disavowing their religious convictions and taking on the convictions of corporate America and global corporations. They're slaves to the dollar. They worship the dollar. They worship popularity and being influencers. We don't have religious convictions. We don't have men bold enough to stand on their religious convictions, other than, I guess, a Russian guy. It's embarrassing for us as Americans.
Yeah. It tells you a lot about our foreign policy, too, I would say. Jason Willock, it is so great to see you, as always. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we've been told that steak is an offense against the climate, against the earth, because cows are a major contributor to global warming because of their flatulence. Cow emissions are destroying the planet. Well, in France, supposedly, farmers have a solution to this problem. We wanted to know if it was real, so we found an actual farmer who's going to test out that plan. Next. Global warming theology is kind of funny because it's so stupid. We can control the weather, but it ceases being amusing when they come for your food supply, which is not a joke, and they are. Farmers from all over the world, from Canada to Sri Lanka, are under attack from global warming lunatics. They're being told they have to sabotage their own operations or else they're destroying the planet and they'll be crushed by BlackRock. Here's the latest example. The French dairy giant Danone says it plans to put masks and diapers on cows to trap their flatulence and burps to reduce methane emissions. So is this some kind of French postmodern play on global warming theology? Is this absurdism at work or are they being serious? We're not sure. We thought we'd check with an actual farmer about whether it'll work. Stephanie Nash is a farmer in the state of Tennessee. She joins us to assess. Stephanie, you're a dairy farmer. You've got a lot of cows behind you. Do you think this would actually work? Would you do it to your cows?
Well, Tucker, you know, I'm not going to wear a mask. I'm not going to allow my cows to wear a mask. I'll show you right now what we're dealing with right now. We tried to put one on. So she's not having it. She is struggling to breathe. And, you know, it just doesn't make sense to put a mask on a cow.
So what you're saying is that cows have more self-respect than most people in Midtown Manhattan on lunch break. Like, they're just not going to be masked.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it's crazy. I'm a big advocate for agriculture and what we do on our dairy farm. Not only are we doing big things to cut emissions, we have ruminants on our farm that can digest byproducts. A good example is we feed our cows soybean meal that comes from soy oil production. And you have to ask yourself, millions of tons per year, if we don't have cows to digest that byproduct, it has to go somewhere. It has to go to a landfill. It has to go on, you know, into a waste management.
Yes.
And that's going to be very harmful. That's going to leave an imprint, you know, for our country, and gas is going into our environment.
Well, speaking of byproducts, and I don't want to get too specific here because this is a family show, but you're very familiar with cows. The idea of putting a diaper on a cow, given the daily production of a cow, is that feasible? How big would the diaper be? Is this a joke? I mean, could you do that? Would you do that?
Yeah, I think these people have gone to Looney Town. There's no possible way that I'm going to put a diaper on my cow. She has to be able to walk around, lay down, eat, drink water, and that's going to make it impossible for her to be comfortable as a cow. You know, our animals are under the best stewardship, and we want them to be as comfortable as possible. And telling me how to do my job is not the way to, you know, eliminate emissions. We have to be smart about this. We have to listen to the farmer or rancher and what is best for our animals.
I've met a lot of global warming scammers who are getting rich from this stuff. I've never met any who know anything about farming. Maybe there are some, but we know that you know a lot about it. So Stephanie, thank you for your insight. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
So the open borders crisis is not just affecting Texas and Arizona and California. 2 weeks ago, hundreds of migrants landed in the Florida Keys. So many arrived, they shut down a national park. There are no signs that this invasion is going to stop, so the governor of Florida, Ron DeSantis, has just activated the Florida National Guard. He's also announced he's considering another major step to secure this country's borders, or at least his state's borders. He says he's weighing a ban to prevent China from purchasing real estate in Florida. Governor Ron DeSantis of Florida joins us now to explain. Governor, thanks so much for coming on. So you're activating the National Guard. What will they do?
So they've been heavy in this ever since we activated, Tucker, over the last week to 10 days. Basically, Biden is leaving the Coast Guard out to dry. He's not sending any more vessels, any more support. They don't have enough to intercept all the boats that are trying to come primarily from Cuba, but also from Haiti. So what we're doing with our assets, we're out there in the Florida Straits. We're using reconnaissance. We are alerting to the Coast Guard when boats are there. We're stopping boats, and then the Coast Guard are picking these folks up. And here's the thing, Tucker. You know, we think that some of this is absolutely being orchestrated by the Cuban government. We think there's a lot of human smuggling going on. So not only is this not good for the Florida Keys to have people dumped on their property, some of these people that are on these boats are being mistreated. And so I think we've seen a decline in the number of vessels that are in the water. We have not had as many landings, actually very few lately. So it is working as a deterrent, but it's our sense that they're going to start trying to change their tactics. So we're going to be watching, and we're going to be responding in kind.
The fact that you're willing to do this is itself a deterrent to smugglers, of course. So one of the challenges in Florida, so many people have moved here that real estate prices have gotten really high. Foreign countries, China specifically, buying up more real estate doesn't help any American. This is happening in other states as well. What is your idea for dealing with this?
We want no CCP land purchases. And obviously, they're not going to do it directly. They will have shell companies. Right. So we're going to have a system in place to scrutinize this. But why would we want them buying farmland? They had very little farmland in the United States even 10 years ago. Now they have significant holdings. Not as much in Florida, but you do have it in other parts of the country. Why would we want the CCP to own land near a military base or own critical infrastructure?
Right.
So we're looking for a flat ban, and so we're going to work with the Florida legislature to get that done. Tucker, American policymakers for a generation have been empowering the CCP. They said it would end up working out. China would become a democracy. In fact, this is a very serious threat to our country. Why would we want them to have even more influence over American society than they already do?
So very short question, Governor. These two things, using the National Guard to protect the borders and preventing a hostile foreign nation from buying up farmland, these are things a lot of other states can be doing but aren't doing. Were they hard for you to do? Is this super hard?
Well, the National Guard we control. I mean, we're putting resources. You know, we have a big budget surplus, Tucker, so we can do that, and people are very happy. You know, we're taking care of the vessels that are landing. Otherwise, the homeowners would have to pay $2,500 a pop. So we're stepping right in where the federal government's failing. I think more states can do it, Tucker, but honestly, we should not have to be doing this. The federal government should be taking care of the immigration issue, and they should be taking care of the CCP issue. With this administration, we know neither of those two things are going to happen.
We're grateful you're doing it. Thank you. Governor Ron DeSantis of Florida. Appreciate it. We'll be right back.
Thanks.
Good evening and welcome to Tucker Carlson Tonight. If you're a normal person, it's a pretty weird experience watching Joe Biden's presidency get euthanized by his own party. On one hand, there's an undeniable thrill to it. You have to admit that. Biden is the most destructive president in American history. More things have broken under his watch than under any other president. Joe Biden deserves to be driven from office and disgraced. But for this, breaking federal classification rules, some of the stupidest and most dishonest laws Congress has ever passed, it's like arresting El Chapo for expired plates. It's missing the point. But it looks like that's what's going to happen. It seems like every day one of Biden's lawyers shows up with more sheaves of classified documents, like a dog who's found another dead chipmunk under the house. This bunch was in his office at Penn, the one paid for by the Communist Party of China. These were found next to his sad little midlife crisis sports car in a garage in Delaware, and so on. You keep waiting for the White House physician to announce another document trove has been discovered after a routine colonoscopy. It could happen. Because at this point, you know exactly where this story is heading. Permanent Washington does not want Joe Biden to run for president again. This is how they're sending that message. Even CNN has decided to become interested in Joe Biden's misdeeds 2 years into his presidency. They're doing segments on how classification laws protect this country from its mortal enemies like Russia. So you know for certain the order has gone out. Biden is done. What a missed opportunity this is. If you're looking for crimes that Joe Biden has committed, there is a very long list. Our country is being invaded. The world is on the brink of nuclear war. American cities have become slums. Our economy is in shambles. Even our airplanes no longer take off on time. It's a disaster, and Joe Biden and his staff have a hand in all of it. In a country with a functioning government, Joe Biden would have been impeached before the first million illegal aliens crossed over our southern border. But no one did anything to stop it. So now they're arriving at the rate of 250,000 a month. Watch.
Customs and Border Protection sources exclusively tell Fox News more than 250,000 migrants were encountered at the border in the month of December, about as many people living in Scottsdale, Arizona, making it the highest month ever on record.
In Eagle Pass, Texas, the migrant surge continues. Local Kinney County rancher Pam Schott had a harrowing experience with migrants on her property.
And I looked out the back and I could see three illegals walking up to the house. I had gotten a gun, which is an AR-15. I asked them, I said, please, you know, stop, go away. And had the gun in my hands and they, you know, just kind of looked at me and kind of smiled. And I was like, I'll tell and just go away, and they refused to do so.
They're on the other side of the glass, trying
to get in
and not backing down.
Not backing down, standing. Even though I have a high, powerful rifle in my arms, they are not backing down. That was scary.
A rifle Joe Biden would like to take away from her. So that, writ large, is the biggest story of our lifetimes. It is the one thing Joe Biden has done that cannot be undone. Our great-grandchildren are going to live with the consequences of this. But you never know it from watching most of the news. There's an effective media blackout on Joe Biden's immigration policies and on their downstream effects on America. There are too many strangers pouring in at once, and as a result, the country is becoming chaotic. Here's a rare television news piece on what happened when officials in New York decided to house some of Joe Biden's illegal aliens in a local hotel.
An employee there says that migrants have made an absolute mess of the place. You're standing in front of it. Is that true?
Yeah, well, what we're hearing from that employee is that the hotel is completely overrun. He says, you know, of course, some people just looking for that better life, but As a result, the hotel is a mess, and he fears for his safety.
We don't have any guests anymore. They sold the entire hotel from the fourth floor to the 28th floor. It's all migrants. Mm-hmm. So we got people who are getting drunk, using marijuana. They are punching and beating their wives or their girlfriends.
Wow.
We have teenagers running around wild around the hotel, opening the fire exit doors and doing what teenagers do in the stairways, and it's a mess.
It's a mess, he said. Of course it is. The whole country is a mess because Joe Biden has ignored immigration laws passed by the Congress. That is a crime, and it has killed huge numbers of Americans, hundreds of thousands dead from narcotics.
Fentanyl has changed the entire game here in San Francisco. You can't buy heroin out here anymore. Nobody sells heroin and nobody uses heroin. Everybody has transitioned over to fentanyl. The fentanyl is the most dangerous drug to ever hit the streets of the United States in history.
Fentanyl has killed more than 70,000 Americans in 12 months. Here in San Francisco, it's the dominant drug. It's responsible for 3/4 of drug overdoses, brazen drug dealing, and rampant drug use. In the shadow of City Hall, the same City Hall residents say actively enabled the fentanyl crisis.
All of it, every gram, came over an open border. So what's notable as a political matter is that every one of these disasters, the fentanyl epidemic, the chaos and crime in our cities, the invasion underway through Texas, Arizona, and California, all of those deeply concern Americans. We're not guessing at that. Polls show it very clearly. By contrast, how many voters do you think are lying awake right now worrying that public officials might violate some obscure federal classification law? None. Not a single person. No one outside Washington cares or even understands the issue. And yet, it is classified documents, not our open borders, that the Justice Department is punishing Joe Biden for. Why is that? What's going on here? Well, it's simple. Washington is protecting itself. Joe Biden alone is responsible for this crime. He alone took home classified documents. He didn't have help in doing that. But allowing the country to be invaded, that's not something you can do by yourself. So if Biden were to be taken down for opening the southern border, a lot of other people would go with him. He had a lot of accomplices. Permanent Washington doesn't want that. And ultimately, and here's the point, permanent Washington is in charge. It's not the democracy you imagine. We're seeing that now. So if you want to understand, if you really want to understand how the American government actually works at the highest levels, and if you want to know why they don't teach history anymore, one thing you should know is that the most popular president in American history was Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon. Yet somehow, without a single vote being cast by a single American voter, Richard Nixon was kicked out of office and replaced by the only unelected president in American history. So we went from the most popular president to a president nobody voted for. Wait a minute, you may ask. Why didn't I know that? Wasn't Richard Nixon a criminal? Wasn't he despised by all decent people? No, he wasn't. In fact, if any president could claim to be the people's choice, it was Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon was reelected in 1972 by the largest margin of the popular vote ever recorded before or since. Nixon got 17 million more votes than his opponent. Less than 2 years later, he was gone. He was forced to resign. And in his place, an obedient servant of the federal agencies called Gerald Ford took over the White House. How did that happen? Well, it's a long story, but here are the highlights, and they tell you a lot. Richard Nixon believed that elements in the federal bureaucracy were working to undermine the American system of government and had been doing that for a long time. He often said that. He was absolutely right. On June 23, 1972, Nixon met with the then CIA director, Richard Helms, at the White House. During the conversation, which thankfully was tape recorded, Nixon suggested he knew, quote, who shot John, meaning President John F. Kennedy. Nixon further implied that the CIA was directly involved in Kennedy's assassination, which we now know it was. Helms' telling response? Total silence. But for Nixon, it didn't matter because it was already over. 4 days before, on June 19th, the Washington Post had published the first of many stories about a break-in at the Watergate office building. Unbeknownst to Nixon and unreported by the Washington Post, 4 of the 5 burglars worked for the CIA. The first of many dishonest Watergate stories was written by a 29-year-old Metro reporter called Bob Woodward. Who exactly was Bob Woodward? Well, he wasn't a journalist. Bob Woodward had no background whatsoever in the news business. Instead, Bob Woodward came directly from the classified areas of the federal government. Shortly before Watergate, Woodward was a naval officer at the Pentagon. He had a top secret clearance. He worked regularly with the intel agencies. At times, Woodward was even detailed to the Nixon White House, where he interacted with Richard Nixon's top aides. Soon after leaving the Navy, for reasons that have never been clear, Woodward was hired by the most powerful news outlet in Washington and assigned the biggest story in the country. And just to make it crystal clear what was actually happening, Woodward's main source for his Watergate series was the deputy director of the FBI, Mark Felt. And Mark Felt ran, and we're not making this up, the FBI's COINTELPRO program, which was designed to secretly discredit political actors the federal agencies wanted to destroy, people like Richard Nixon. And at the same time, those same agencies were also working to take down Nixon's elected vice president, Spiro Agnew. In the fall of 1973, Agnew was indicted for tax evasion and forced to resign. His replacement was a colorless congressman from Grand Rapids called Gerald Ford. What was Ford's qualification for the job? Well, he had served on the Warren Commission, which absolved the CIA of responsibility for President Kennedy's murder. Nixon was strong-armed into accepting Gerald Ford by Democrats in Congress. Quote, "We gave Nixon no choice but Ford," Speaker of the House Carl Albert later boasted. 8 months later, Gerald Ford of the Warren Commission was the president of the United States. See how that works? So those are the facts, not speculation. All of that actually happened. None of it's secret. Most of it actually is on Wikipedia. But no mainstream news organization has ever told that story. It's so obvious, yet it's intentionally ignored. And as a result, permanent Washington remains in charge of our political system. Unelected lifers in the federal agencies make the biggest decisions in American government and crush anyone who tries to rein them in. And in the process, our democracy becomes a joke. Now, you may have noticed that the very first person in the Trump administration the agencies went after was General Michael Flynn. Why Flynn? Because Mike Flynn was a career Army intel officer who ran the Defense Intelligence Agency. In other words, Mike Flynn knew exactly how the system worked. And as a result, he was capable of fighting back. 4 days after Donald Trump's inauguration, the FBI lured Mike Flynn into a meeting without his lawyer, concocted a series of fake crimes, and forced him to resign. So that's how things actually work in Washington. Let's stop lying about it. Joe Biden, meanwhile, whooped like a hyena when the Justice Department destroyed Mike Flynn. So there is, we have to say, a certain perverse justice in watching something very similar happen to Joe Biden himself 6 years later. Joe Biden does not deserve our sympathy. He's being shafted, but don't weep for him. And yet the rest of us do deserve a better system, an actual democracy. When people nobody voted for run everything, you are not living in a free country. Will Cain is the co-host of Fox and Friend Weekend, the host of the Will Cain podcast, and our friend. He joins us tonight. Will Cain, thanks so much for coming on. I think it's very obvious that Biden is being shafted by his own people, people whose identities will probably never come to light. But I find it interesting it's on this traffic ticket offense and not on the fact that he's destroying the country by opening the southern border. Why is no one saying that?
You know, I think it also, Tucker, could even begin in a more entertaining and petty fashion in that I think the story begins with Joe Biden's senility and incompetence, so much so that Democratic politicians and those who have a vested interest in using Joe Biden as a useful idiot go, wow, he's kneeling in front of the Golden State Warriors. Wow, he's calling Kamala Harris president. This guy can't be elected again. He can no longer be our useful idiot. I think his term as their useful idiot has expired. And so they're willing to now indulge in this, as you point out, classified traffic ticket. There's classified documents floating all over Washington in unsecured locations. But what I find fascinating, Tucker, is they're also willing to say that there are potential, we know this, you and I know this, everyone watching knows this, corrupt government deals between the Biden family and foreign adversaries that are antagonistic to the American interest. I'm shocked to see that kind of thing on, for example, CNN now, talking about Joe Biden's brother. And so that leads us to this. If And I agree with the terminology. If permanent Washington thinks Joe Biden can no longer serve as their useful idiot, he can't be reelected in 2024, it's time to sell him down the river. And it's time to come up with a more important and harder job for them, finding another name.
What's infuriating to me, and again, I just want to say if anyone deserves this kind of treatment, it's the guy who hates the country he leads, Joe Biden. So I'm not weeping for him. But I do think, call me naive, voters ought to be in charge of these decisions. In a democracy, voters get to decide who the president is. They can vote for anyone they want because it's their country. I have to say, I'm wondering how long it's going to be before Michelle Obama starts getting warm and affectionate treatment on CNN.
Well, first to Joe Biden, and I understand you're not extending sympathy, but I guess here's the moral of that story. Tucker, live by the sword, die by the sword.
Yes.
If you are elected through manipulation of the American public and anti-democratic means, which no doubt about it, the election 2 years ago was anti-democratic at the very least by manipulating the public's access to information and therefore our minds, then you will go down by the same very same powers that aided you on your way to perceived power. Now, you have said this. You have mentioned the name Michelle Obama. I think the Democrats are in a real tough spot. It maybe. Or does Gavin Newsom get the treatment you're describing for Michelle Obama? You're going to have trouble. You and I are going to have trouble coming up with any other name outside of those two, I would suggest. Michelle Obama, Gavin Newsom.
Man, if they can sell Gavin Newsom after what he has done to the state of California, then you will know it's all fake. Because no one who lands at LAX is going to vote for that guy.
Hey, Tucker, on the state of the country, I want to say one thing, if I might, about fentanyl. I watched that footage you put up, and it is sad to see zombified Americans sitting there choosing synthetic opioids now over heroin. But the real story of fentanyl is the 16-year-old girl who buys Xanax over the internet and dies overnight. Yeah. It's the 20-year-old guy who thinks he's buying Adderall. They're still doing something wrong, but they're not overdosing. They're being poisoned by drug cartels and the Chinese Communist Party.
That's exactly right. It's murder. I couldn't agree more. Will Cain, it's great to see you tonight. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
So it's been over a year since Alec Baldwin shot and killed someone on the set of his movie. Remember that? Alec Baldwin shot someone to death? Well, there's been a major update in the criminal case in that shooting. We'll tell you what it is. Plus, a new study reveals some amazing benefits for men who use Viagra, beyond just the obvious ones. That's straight ahead. It's been 15 months since Alec Baldwin shot and killed the cinematographer working on his movie Rust. There's a major update in that case tonight. Fox's Trace Gallagher, as usual, has it for us now. Hey, Trace.
Hey, Tucker, after announcing that actor Alec Baldwin and the film's armorer, Hannah Gutierrez-Reed, would face involuntary manslaughter charges, Santa Fe, New Mexico District Attorney Mary Carmack Altweiss said nobody is above the law and Alec Baldwin had a duty never to point a gun at a person while pulling the trigger. But Alec Baldwin, of course, denies pulling the trigger. Watch.
It wasn't in the script.
But a short time ago on The Five, a New Mexico prosecutor working the case contradicted Alec Baldwin. Watch.
We definitely believe he pulled the trigger. The FBI lab report confirms that, so definitely the trigger was pulled.
Meantime, Alec Baldwin made it clear through his attorney that he disagrees with the charges and plans to fight them. Quoting here, this decision distorts Helena Hutchins' tragic death and represents a terrible miscarriage of justice. Helena Hutchins was working as a cinematographer when she was accidentally shot and killed by Alec Baldwin, who was practicing how to use a Colt 45 revolver. One lawyer I spoke with said Baldwin has a strong case because he was handed a gun that he was told did not have live bullets. But other attorneys point out that Baldwin knew the gun had misfired before. And if he goes to trial, a jury might come back with a firearms enhancement. And instead of just facing 18 months in jail, he could be looking to 5 years. Tucker.
Trace Gallagher, thank you for that.
Yep.
If you want more Trace, and we do, every night, Fox News, midnight Eastern. Sue Brumbaugh worked with the armor on Rust, Hannah Gutierrez, on a different project with Nicolas Cage. Brumbaugh says that Gutierrez handled guns recklessly on that set and that there are many Hollywood projects where actors like Alec Baldwin are mishandling firearms and have no idea what they are doing. Probably not surprising, but interesting. Sue Brumbaugh is an actor, key grip, and owner of Sparta Grip. He joins us tonight. Sue, thanks so much for coming on. So you've seen this. I mean, the rest of us would, I guess, assume that a lot of actors who are, of course, against the Second Amendment probably don't know a lot about guns. But you're saying you have seen actors mishandle firearms.
Yeah. Thanks for having me on, first of all, Tucker. I appreciate it. In my industry, you know, we deal with a lot of firearm scenarios. Obviously, we've got a lot of Hollywood people that will vilify firearms and then end up on their TV shows and movies and glorify them in those instances. And, you know, it's just the hypocrisy of it. I try and be professional on set, but you run into those instances where you've watched somebody, you know, make statements on their TV shows or their, you know, their interviews, and then you see them on the sets working and they're, you know, trying to be, you know, using the firearms. It's just comical.
Well, it's a little weird that people who think guns are evil would be, as you said, glorifying their use, playing the tough guy, you know, pointing guns in people's faces on the set. I mean, have you ever seen an actor decline a role because it involved guns?
I'm sure the paychecks far outweigh their, their feelings towards firearms.
So I guess it goes without saying that a lot of these are people who really just don't know anything about firearms.
That's correct. I mean, you see them have these conversations on the news channels and with politicians and everything else about firearms. And then, you know, you hear things. I mean, I grew up around guns. I grew up in Montana. I'm an avid outdoorsman. I've been hunting my entire life.
Too.
And, you know, you hear them talk about firearms and they totally don't understand even the mechanics of them to begin with.
Yes.
And they're trying to make their point across of why they're so bad and evil and everything else. And, you know, honest, hardworking, you know, citizens that, you know, love guns. And, you know, my guns have never harmed anybody or never been in the hands of anybody that would do harm. And, you know, you just look at those scenarios and then you kind of have to keep quiet on these movie sets and end up working with these individuals.
And not just you. I've, you know, been on, you know, lots of different sets. And there is this huge divide between the people who are getting paid the most and who are on camera. And then everybody, the army of people off camera who you never see, I would say the majority of whom don't share the politics of the people on camera. Has that been your experience?
Absolutely not. In my industry, you know, there's always the, you know, the conversations behind the camera. And, you know, I think a lot of people probably feel very similar to the way that I feel when it comes to these issues. You know, but of course, we're not making the $10 million paycheck. So, you know, we're just there to do our job and do it to the best of our ability.
Well, I, for one, wish you were making the $10 million.
I do, too.
Stu, thanks for joining us tonight. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
So letting in 250,000 foreign nationals illegally into this country every month, which the Biden administration is now doing, is having a huge effect, an irreparable effect on the entire country. It's affecting farmers, too. Now, we're going to speak to one who has seen what this looks like. That's next. The number of illegal aliens streaming across our border has just hit a new all-time record. Never before have we seen anything like this. More than 250,000 foreign nationals were stopped last month alone. So that's an invasion. There's no other word for it. It's having an effect on every part of American life. It's having an effect on farmers. Alex Mueller is a farmer in Yuma, Arizona, the president of the Pasquinelli Produce Company. He joins us tonight to tell us what he has firsthand been experiencing. Alex, thanks so much for coming on. So we don't hear often enough from people in border states about what it looks like to them. What's your experience been?
Well, hello, Tucker. No, thanks for having me. It's over the last 2 years, it's just been a death by a thousand cuts. It's been a slow trickle, and we're seeing it every day. We're right, this is the end of the border here. And we have a field of lettuce here. And the community here has seen an uptick in crossers. And it's just been continuous and continuous. And it's taxing. And it's hard for us to do our jobs when we take food safety as at the utmost for what we do. And anytime anybody enters our field, we have to cordon that off and flag it. And we don't harvest that area, just like if a coyote enters our field, we can't harvest that area. So when there's 20 people, 30 people, but sometimes there's 100 out there. About a quarter mile down, mostly they cross, but there's gaps along the wall that they're crossing over, and it's an additional aspect of our job that is sort of out of our wheelhouse.
Well, you shouldn't have to contend with border security. You're a lettuce farmer. The state and the federal government should be doing that for you. That's their main job. That's why they exist. Are they? And why aren't they? Apparently they're not.
Well, no, they're not. And we're, you know, we live in a border community, and the Border Patrol are our friends, and the Border Patrol are glorified travel agency now. And, you know, they're people cross the down here a quarter mile, and Border Patrol comes down and they put people in buses. They take them to a tent city where the Border Patrol station is. There's probably 5,000 people there at any given time, and they're giving them bus passes or airplane tickets, and they're flying all over the country. And it's been insane to watch for the last 2 years, and it's something that we need help down here, and we want to bring light to this situation.
Of course. You're so meticulous in your job that you just told us if a coyote crosses into your field, you will not sell the produce the coyote touched. So how does it feel
to... We don't sell the produce and...
Right, but so here's the government abetting crime. The people who are supposed to be stopping the crime are making it possible, rewarding the crime with free airline tickets. As an American, how does that feel?
Well, at a time, you know, we're coming out of the pandemic and at a time when all of costs across the board are up. Our freight costs are up double. Fuel costs are up 30%. Input costs are up 30%. It's an additional cost that it gets sent down to the end user, the American public. And we're very proud of what we do. My wife's family has been farming here for 75 years, and we're one of the young guys on the block. And we're proud of this. We're proud of what we provide to the American people. And this has been going on for 2 years. It's not stopping. I mean, I could tell you anecdotally a couple stories where a Border Patrol agent friend of mine saw somebody crossing that had two people crossing with him that he was paying to carry his Louis Vuitton luggage. And then on the same hand, I've seen a little girl crossing that was a five-year-old with a phone number pinned to her chest, and she was alone. I saw that with my own eyes. And it's been going on for 2 years. And we need help down here. It's not something that it's in our wheelhouse. It's not something the city of Yuma needs to deal with.
Of course.
But
not.
Yeah, we'd like to get some help.
Oh, the wonders never cease. We told you recently about a nurse who woke up from a coma after getting a dose of Viagra. She was being treated for COVID, and reportedly the Viagra may have helped her. So write down another potential benefit of Viagra. Researchers at the University of Southern California say Viagra can lower the risk of heart disease in men by nearly 40%. It can also reduce the risk of early death. So it's not just, apparently, for randy old men. It's a wonder drug. Dr. Mark Siegel has been following Viagra for quite some time. Its other uses, he joins us tonight. Hey, doctor.
Tucker, you know, it's actually used for altitude sickness and quite proven for that. And you and I talked on the show recently about how it seems to prevent the spread, the progression of Alzheimer's. But the heart is what it was originally studied for. You may not know this, but and maybe you do. They actually studied this as a blood pressure drug and for heart drug. And the nurses that were studying the patients said, hey, what's going on under those towels? And that's how it got its famous use. So it was left behind, the heart issue, but now we're coming back to it. And a huge study out of the Journal of Sexual Medicine has just shown, looking at 70,000 men, 24,000 of them who were taking some kind of a erectile dysfunction drug, either Viagra or Cialis or Levitra, from 2006 to 2020, average age 52, they discovered that there was a 40% less chance of dying of heart disease, 25% chance of not dying at all in that group over that period of time. That is really, really incredible. And also, as you said, less heart disease altogether. Now, what might be going on here? You know, it's possible that sexual activity itself could be part of this. I mean, sex releases a happy hormone, right? And that relaxes the heart and relaxes the whole body. But I think Viagra is playing a role here because Viagra releases nitric oxide, which dilates the blood vessels everywhere in the body, including the heart. It keeps the heart from clamping down. It keeps the heart relaxed. So for those men out there tonight who were already smiling because they had their Cialis or their Viagra, I'm going to add to you, you know, smile a little more because of the brain and the heart. And by the way, Siegel's prescription, it's not yet ready for prime time so that people out there should take it who aren't already benefiting from it, Tucker.
The Journal of Sexual Medicine, do you subscribe?
I'm going to now. 70,000 men, University of Southern California. That is a big one, and it is a big journal and a great result.
Me too. I'm dropping the Atlantic, picking up the Journal of Sexual Medicine. Dr. Siegel.
And this is your age range, Tucker. This is your age range. So
I can't continue. Thank you. Good to see you. On a sadder note, the Department of Justice has set out, this is not an overstatement, to destroy the lives of anyone who showed up at the Capitol to protest the 2020 election on January 6th. Not people who committed acts of violence or vandalism, people who were just there. So obviously this is political retribution. It's the kind of thing that you'd expect in a totalitarian country. DOJ has created a public January 6th registry, like a sex offender registry. No one has stopped this. And this registry includes anyone accused of any crime relating to January 6th, including misdemeanors. Brandon Strzok is on that registry. He's never been convicted of a felony, but as a result of being on that registry, he can no longer live in this country like you or I can. Banks are refusing to offer him services. He's the founder of the Walk Away campaign, and he joins us tonight. Brandon, thanks so much for coming on. So just, we've gone through the shocking details of your case at some length, but just to bottom line it, you've never been convicted of a felony, much less any act of violence. You didn't commit any act of violence or vandalism. Tell us what this registry has done to your life.
Right, Tucker. So as you pointed out, it's not just people who have been convicted of crimes. It's anybody who's even accused of any crimes by the government. So the moment that the FBI storms into your house, puts you in handcuffs and takes you to jail and the government creates their narrative about your case, you go onto this registry. And I think it's worth noting, too, that the government seems to be spending top dollar on search engine optimization, because for all of us, this is the top result when you Google any of our names. It's the very first result that will appear. Now, in my case, the FBI came into my house, they put me in jail, put me in handcuffs, and then told me that I was facing multiple felony charges. They charged me with two felonies and a misdemeanor and threatened me with a third felony, which was obstruction of Congress. So I was potentially facing decades in prison for the 8 minutes that I stood outside of the Capitol filming a video on a camera. When I weighed my options, I made the decision that rather than going against this, I would plead guilty to their misdemeanor charge, their misdemeanor plea deal. In the 11th hour, in the final hearing before my sentencing, I'm going to read directly to you from the prosecution. This is from the transcript of my case. The prosecutor said just before my sentencing hearing to the judge, "Your Honor, we don't have any information that he would have been able to be charged with a felony. He didn't go inside the Capitol. We don't have any reason to have charged him with a felony. There wasn't any consideration, at least that I'm aware of, that Mr. Strzok was ever able to be charged with a felony offense. Nonetheless, they did charge me with felonies. I pled guilty to a misdemeanor. And when you Google my name and you look at this dossier that the government has compiled against me and every other J6er, it includes every accusation, including those felonies that they originally charged me with and are now admitting that they never had any justification to charge me with in the first place. And to answer your question, what has this done to my life? Well, every J6er that I'm aware of has been permanently banned by PayPal, Venmo, Stripe, Patreon. People have been debanked. And just as recently as yesterday, I received a notification from a company. I'm working with a wonderful company from Delaware called Metro Payment Technologies that's actually helping people who are being deplatformed. They're a payment processing company. They're amazing. But they were trying to help me set up a new account with a banking institution. And we received a letter back yesterday on my application in which the banking institution said, "Unfortunately, we are going to have to decline based on the owner's involvement and subsequent conviction surrounding the January 6th Capitol riot." So on my Class B misdemeanor charge, more than 2 years later, I'm still being denied the access to banking institutions, payment processors. And Tucker, I'd like to point out too, on my Class B misdemeanor charge, I spent 2.5 days in jail. I spent 3 months on house arrest. I'm on federal probation for 3 years, 60 hours of community service. I have a $5,000 fine, $500 restitution. I have paid and served every element of my sentence. I have, I believed, paid my debt to society. That's and yet sure. Now I'm still being punished. The punishment doesn't seem to ever end.
No. I'm rooting for the bankruptcy of any company that joins in punishing you for doing nothing wrong. Brandon Strzok, thank you so much for coming on tonight.
I have no sound.